Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Dr. Amit Borse and I am a Senior Product Manager with IVA, a division of MQR Pharmaceuticals Limited, a pioneer in the field of gynecology and IVF. We at MQR are on a mission to nurture and support 28 days with Programming 28, which is the foundation of ART. Programming 28 is based on the concept of ovarian cycle and managing the same with exogenously given GnRH analogs, gonadotropins and hormones as per different protocol. MQR promises to deliver all possible support in terms of therapeutic agents and academic support like this. We are very thankful to ISAR and Infertility Committee FOXI to give us an opportunity yet again to be the academic partner. Today we have many eminent speakers with us, but I would like Dr. Kundan Ingle sir to take it forward. Dr. Kundan Ingle sir is the chairperson for Infertility Committee FOXI. Sir, may I now request you to please take over the session?
Thank you, Amit. Good afternoon, everybody. I welcome all of you for webinar series by Indian Society of Assisted Reproduction along with Infertility Committee of FOXI. Before I start, I'm thankful to President FOXI, Dr. Alpesh Gandhi, President ISAR, Dr. Prakash Trivedi, Dr. Jaideep Tang, Honorary Secretary of FOXI, and Dr. Kedar Gandla, Secretary to ISAR. And of course, this activity is under leadership of Dr. Ramani Devi, Vice President of FOXI. And I welcome all of you. I think we are having a great time of these webinars. I think most of you have witnessed lots of good panel discussions in the past. A couple of weeks back, we had fertility laparoscopic surgery station, and it was a very great, huge hit, and it was much appreciated by the delegates. To continue our memorandum, we decided to take now a second part of endoscopy, which is most important in ART, which is hysteroscopy. So today we are going to focus our discussion completely on hysteroscopy in ART. And to do that, I have another great feast of panelists from all across the India. And again, we have a great moderator who has done a fantastic job while doing this panel on fertility enhancing laparoscopic surgery. So we requested him to continue that discussion for hysteroscopy. I welcome Dr. Sanket Pisat. He's a gynecological endoscopic surgeon from Mumbai, a very, very renowned endoscopist from Mumbai, a very young, enthusiastic blood. And I think a lot of inventions to his credit and his creativity. I really appreciate Sanket for your all those contributions, which is making our practice more easy and easy. So keep doing that. We have eminent panelists. Let me welcome Dr. Sunil Shaha. He is a joint secretary of FOXI, secretary to Ahmedabad Obstetric and Gynec Society, and joint secretary to Gujarat chapter of ISAR. He's a prominent figure in IVF from Ahmedabad. I welcome Dr. Sunil Shah for this panel. May I invite Dr. Venu Gopal. He's a secretary, Kerala Federation of Obstetric and Gynecology, and he's an ART specialist practicing at Thrissur. Dr. Pooja Mehta, she is a head of the department, Fortis Bloom IVF Center at Mohali, Punjab. And she's also a founder secretary to Chandigarh chapter of ISAR. I think we're a very knowledgeable person from Punjab. I welcome Dr. Nilesh Balkavde. He is a clinical head and fertility specialist at Oasis IVF Center, which is recently started in Pune. Very active member of Pune Obstetric and Gynec Society, and as well as he's standing for quiz committee of FOXI for this year elections. Dr. Vimi Bindra, she's a consultant gynecologist and endoscopic surgeon at Apollo Health City, Hyderabad. Another very brilliant endoscopic surgeon. So we tried to get all the endoscopies, pure ART practitioners together. Let me welcome Dr. Sushila Saini. She's a president of Association of Gynec Endoscopic of Rajasthan. She is secretary to Rajasthan chapter of IAG. She is a scientific committee member of Jaipur OBGYN Society, and she's a director of Jaipur Durbin Hospital. I know her personally, a very courageous endoscopic surgeon from Jaipur. and a upcoming national faculty for gynec endoscopic association. So I welcome all of you, and let us hear out from all these experts about hysteroscopy in ART. I request Sanket to start the discussion.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. I am going to share my screen now, and then we will get started with the discussion. You will have to stop your screen sharing, Dr. Amit. Okay, fine, I'm done. Okay, is everybody able to see the screen now?
Dr. Amit's screen now.
Dr. Amit Borse's screen is
moving. Okay, Dr. Amit, you will have to stop your sharing. No, still not?
No.
Yeah, we can see here. It's moderator Dr. Sanket.
Yes. So you should be able to see my PPT.
Yes.
See Dr. Sanket here.
Not able to see?
No. It's Dr. Amit's screen.
I think Dr. Amit. Hello.
I can see. I can see your PPT.
No, listen to me. I am going to stop my sharing. You also stop your screen sharing, and then I will start again. Okay. I'm stopping my screen sharing now. Okay. Can you also stop your screen sharing and switch to the camera mode completely? Dr. Amit?
I request all the delegates to just bear for a couple of minutes.
I think there is some issue with Dr. Amit's computer. I'm going to try to share my screen again and see if it is visible to all of you. So here goes for the second time.
I can see your video.
Yes. So now is everybody able to see the PPT that is displayed?
Yes. Now we can see.
Fine. So thank you, Dr. Amit. I think we are sorted. Let's Thank get you, started sir. With the discussion. Right. So, thank you, sir, for that kind introduction, Dr. Kundan Ingre. And without spending any more time, we will directly now get to the point. So, for the panelists and for the audience, there are certain specific instructions that we would like you to follow. Since our audience today is going to be predominantly an audience that is not composed only of gynec endoscopic surgeons, but rather we have a mixed audience. Some of you are doing purely an obstetric practice with some infertility practice. Some of you are having an exclusive ART practice. Some are doing endoscopy. But for the sake of it being beneficial to everyone, we are going to focus today on when to operate and when not to operate, rather than how to operate. So meaning that if we are discussing polypectomy, we are going to be more concerned about how the polyp is, which polyps are to be removed, which polyps are not to be removed. Does polypectomy help the patient to get pregnant or not? And we are going to talk less about how the polyp should be removed, where you should cut with the scissor, how deep you should cut, and things like that. So that is going to be our primary focus. For ease of discussion, we are going to remove all confounding factors like non-fertility symptoms, male subfertility, endocrine problems, socioeconomic factors, patient not affording. All that is not going to be a part of today's discussion. So when we discuss the cases, it is assumed that the patient is infertile. The problem that is being discussed is the problem at hand, and everything else is normal. We are not doing any medical management discussions today. The fourth point, we are also going to discuss some literature, but what I would like each of you to do is to answer purely out of your own expertise. It may not correspond to published evidence, which is fine. It is the norm to disagree, and only in that we will be able to find practical answers that are suitable for our day-to-day practice. Also, I urge you to keep the discussion simple so that we are able to give the delegates at least a few take-home messages with which they can improve their actual day-to-day practice. The images are shown for representational purposes only. They may not necessarily match to the discussion that we are having. So what exactly are we going to discuss? Diagnostic hysteroscopy, pre-IVF hysteroscopy, polyps, the septate and subseptate uterus, T-shaped uterus, submucous fibroids, Asherman's syndrome, and some rare findings. So we have quite a few things to discuss. But before we start that, there is one surprise entry. And that surprise entry is a grand celebrity who has agreed to be a co-moderator for today's discussion. And this celebrity is going to keep us hitched onto the discussion by hosting his favorite game show on our discussion today. So let's see how he contributes to our poll and our discussion today. So the best part of this webinar today is going to be the audience poll, meaning that before we start discussing points about what we feel, we would like to know from the audience what you feel about a particular topic, what is your opinion, and then the experts will have a discussion on how what points are correct and what points need to be changed. So without wasting any further time, Dr. Amit, are you ready with the questions?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I'm going to first read out the question and then I will ask you to project it on screen. The options will come to you as options on your screen and you can click the option that you feel is correct. Again, this is for the participants only, not for the experts in the panel. So you have a patient, she's a 32-year-old lady. She has a normal sonography report. The ET is 11 mm in the second half of the cycle. She's had 2 years of trying to conceive. IUI has failed twice and there is nothing else normal. There is nothing else abnormal, nothing in the sonography. Both tubes are open in the HSG, but she does not want to undergo laparoscopy. She's scared. So in your opinion, this patient A requires hysteroscopy. Second, you will do hysteroscopy if the IUI fails one more time. Third, you feel that she does not require hysteroscopy. Or fourth, you feel, forget all this. Let's just directly go for an IVF. Dr. Amit, please flash the questions on the screen and let us see what the audience wants to do.
Here it is.
We have 30 seconds in which this poll will go on. After 30 seconds, we will stop the poll and start with the discussion. Okay, I think we can stop the poll. Right, so these are the results. 60% of you have said that this patient does require hysteroscopy. So now let us see actually what is happening. Okay, can I move on to the next slide?
Can you see this slide, sir?
Yes. Sanket.
Yes, sir.
Actually, in mobile, only two options were visible.
Oh.
So just say that you can scroll it and you can watch.
Okay.
Because many people might not have touched the screen.
Okay, okay. So I think you'll have to scroll down to see the rest of the options.
Okay, sir, we can go ahead now.
Right. So now, let us start. Let's start with the panelists now. Dr. Venugopal, sir, if we may start with you.
Yes.
Among these four, what do you think is the correct management for this patient? And could you please explain why you feel so?
Yes, here we are discussing about the screening hysteroscopy. What I mean is that the HSG is normal, tubes are open, there's nothing in the ultrasound. And then the patient has gone ahead with attempts at becoming pregnant. So according to me, she does not require a hysteroscopy at this
point. Okay, she does not require hysteroscopy.
She does not require hysteroscopy at this stage.
So, because, sir, what will be your management now? Will you take her for IVF directly or repeat IUI?
No, I may repeat an IUI because I have my protocols for IUI. When I start doing an IUI for a patient, I do 3 attempts at IUI. And then, I decide whether I want to shift the patient to IVF or not.
Okay, fair enough. So, let's take the opinion of Dr. Pooja Mehta. Madam, what would your opinion be?
Hi, Sanket. Yeah, I really feel that definitely we should be doing one more cycle of IUI. Going again straight away for a hysteroscopy is not recommended at this stage. She's a young patient, just tried for 2 years. Definitely we can go ahead for a IUI cycle. And plus, maybe we can add some GnRH analogs and all in the IUI and increase the success rate of IUI. You know, I think that is the only thing which I will do. Definitely no hysteroscopy straight away. Definitely after one cycle of IUI. And if still it is negative, then maybe we'll think of a hysteroscopy, endometrial evaluation, and then go ahead. You know, that's what I feel.
Okay. Dr. Nilesh Balkavde, sir, what is your opinion?
Yes. Thank you, Sanket. Looks like a case of unexplained infertility till now. And second thing is that we cannot call it as a case of failed IUI because 3 or 4 attempts have not been done. According to me, I'll go for 3 or 4 attempts of IUI and then plan the then change the course of action. So if this question would have been 3 IUI failed, then my answer would have been a diagnostic office hysteroscopy or maybe a diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy to rule out other causes of unexplained infertility.
Okay, so you feel that minimum 3 attempts are required. We will just take opinions of the remaining 3 panelists and then we'll shift the discussion. Dr. Sunil Shah, sir, what would you do? You would want to do hysteroscopy or you think you want to repeat IUI?
Dr. Sanket, in fact, looking to the age of a lady, I would also like to know the AMS, right? Mm-hmm. And if this, I consider it as a little advantage, so I will prefer to go for a better option and that would be an IVF.
Okay. Okay. So before we are going to take the option of IVF also. Let's see what Dr. Vimi Bindra and Dr. Sushila Saini have to say. Dr. Vimi Bindra, would your opinion match to the other panelists or do you have anything different to say?
I agree that it's a case of unexplained infertility and but it's 2 years she has been trying. So I would like to do a screening hysteroscopy, maybe office hysteroscopy. Because patients also get impatient when they have been receiving treatment for such a long time. So if we can show them, yes, cavity is fine and we can try for 1 or 2 more cycles of IUI. Okay. So I would like to do a screening hysteroscopy at this point of time.
Okay. Dr. Sushila, madam, what is your...
Yeah, I am also considering, like Dr. Vimik, I will do the hysteroscopy because many a time, many surprises are present in the uterine cavity. There may be internal os block, maybe there... a cervical canal problem may be there and there may be a problem susceptate uterus or many things which is missed in the sonography, which actually many time accidentally diagnosed during the diagnostic hysteroscopy. And office hysteroscopy is a very good tool.
Okay.
We need not any anesthesia and we can do right away in the office and without any anesthesia and without any problem to the patient. And patient is also viewing the screen and she's also aware about the treatment and what is going on. Actually, she is also connected with the thing in the office hysteroscopy.
Okay.
So office hysteroscopy gives a very good view of the cavity and any problem if they're missing because she's trying since last 2 years. Hmm. And by the end of the 2 year, patient mentally actually very much down and she's actually bas mujhe to aap kaise bhi conceive kara dijiye. That's
fair.
All.
Fair enough. So this is actually a classical case of the ART specialist versus the endoscopic surgeon.
Yes.
I was on the panel. Then I would also side with Dr. Vimi Bindra and Dr. Sushila Saini.
Yes.
But the situation forces me.
Waters with us.
So coming back to Dr. Venu Gopal sir, for this particular patient, does it matter 2 IUI, 3 IUI? Is there some black? I mean, is there some fixed line, some patthar ki lakir ki? 3 IUIs have to be done before you subject her to hysteroscopy. Is it not prudent to do hysteroscopy right now and save her the agony of one more IUI? Your frank opinion, sir.
No. I see. It is not about the number of IUIs. It's just a question of whether a procedure needs to be done or not. And then if you are going to do a procedure, is there sufficient, you know, like benefits from that procedure? And what does the sort of evidence sort of say that, you know, if you are doing a screening hysteroscopy, is it going to give you benefit? Now, see, what is evident in our panel here is what you said, you know, then that there are 2 groups of people, ART specialists and then there are surgeons. So that's very clear. So, So, see, what happens is even in studies, there is always an element of bias. If you, there's always an element of bias. But then what I would like to point out to the audience in reference to this polyp is, if you just run a search for this, there is a Google, there's a Cochrane study by our own Mohan Kamath.
So to continue on this question, Dr. Pooja Mehta, what I wanted to know is, so in your opinion, does hysteroscopy has got no role in this patient unless 3 or 4 IUIs fail? Doing a hysteroscopy now is not really going to enhance the chances of her getting pregnant, and you would really like to wait for one more cycle.
See, Sanket, it's not about cycle. It's like she's 32 years, till I would say less than 35 years of age, 2 years of marriage. And one more thing which I would add is maybe I'll add an investigation of a 3-dimensional ultrasound, which is a non-invasive investigation.
Okay.
And maybe with that, if at all there is any problem in that 3D ultrasound, okay, then I might think of a hysteroscopy. But at present, yes, I will not, because a patient of 32 years, as rightly said by the panelists, they will definitely be anxious. So a thorough counseling and telling them the pros and cons of everything is better. I feel going straight away for a hysteroscopy is something,
okay,
you know, I feel we'll wait. I'll wait for some time. At least this is my personal opinion.
Definitely. Okay, so 3D ultrasound is what you're suggesting as a stopgap between doing an invasive procedure and waiting. Fine.
Exactly,
so we will go on now to the next, this thing, same patient. Okay, the same patient, everything, age, everything same, but she has made up her mind. She's had enough of it. She would like to directly go for IVF. Now, I pose the same question again. Would you do a hysteroscopy or would you like to start the cycle directly? Before seeing any further discussions, I would like each of you to answer this and then we'll move on. Hysteroscopy or start the cycle directly? Just a yes, no answer.
No.
No. Sir. I'll ask one by one.
Okay.
Yeah. Otherwise, we will have a fight. Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam, your answer, yes or no?
Okay, if I go for IVF, I'll first of all go for stimulation. I'll do first, as I said before also, I'll do a 3D ultrasound and then decide.
It's normal.
Should do a hysteroscopy and go straight away.
Ultrasound is normal, madam. 3D ultrasound is normal.
Okay, then I'll go for IVF. I will not do hysteroscopy.
Okay, no. Dr. Nilesh Balkavde.
In pre-IVF hysteroscopy, a very big no to it. Unless it is a case of recurrent implantation failure or otherwise.
Okay. Dr. Sunil Shah, sir, what is your opinion?
No.
You, sir, will not do a pre-IVF hysteroscopy.
And as rightly said by Dr. Pooja, I always do a good transvaginal 3D sonography, very careful sonography with color Doppler. That is very important. Yes.
Okay. Okay, but you rely completely on that so much that you think that pre-IVF hysteroscopy is not required. If you have done the scan yourself, you are sure it is normal, then you can directly go for IVF. Correct?
As Dr. Nilesh has rightly said that unless it is a recurrent implantation failure,
okay,
right, and 11 millimeter endometrium is a good healthy endometrium.
Okay.
So I think we can give one chance. That's that. There is no doubt that we are going to get any good polyp or something like which is a cause of the subfertility for
okay,
that.
Okay, so, okay. Let's see what the others have to say. Dr. Vimi Bindra.
I would like to do an office hysteroscopy if possible.
Okay. Dr. Sushila Saini.
मैं एक ही बात कहूंगी अगर आप
पहले
इतना बड़ा प्रोसीजर करना चाह रहे
यस बताइए मैडम
एक लाइन बोलना चाहूंगी वन लाइन ओनली कि अगर आप इतना बड़ा प्रोसीजर करना चाह रहे कि 1.5 लाख अगर पेशेंट खर्च कर रहा है और अगर आप उसका बिना देखे आपने अंदर देखा ही नहीं कि व्हाट इज एग्जैक्टली इनसाइड आपने डायरेक्टली नहीं देखा यू आर जस्ट अज्यूमिंग बाय द सोनोग्राफी बाय द 3D और MRI और बाय द ट्रांसवजाइनल सोनोग्राफी बट यू हैव नॉट सीन डायरेक्टली इनटू द यूटराइन कैविटी एंड यू आर इम्प्लांटिंग द एम्ब्रायो and then giving a chance to fail. There may be chance because it is not 100%. Agar aap apni hi practice mein ek chance aur kyun dena cha rahe hain kharab karne
ke liye. Excellent. So madam, I will take your question only and I will put it to Dr. Venugopal first and to Dr. Pooja Mehta later. If patient is anyways going to spend and going to go through the IVF cycle, what is the harm in doing one office procedure that takes 10 minutes to perform and costs hardly a minuscule of what it is going to take?
डायरेक्शन पता होगा इट विल गिव यू प्रॉपर एम्ब्रायो ट्रांसफर
point.
It will give you a proper exact image of the endometrial cavity.
Okay, Venugopal sir.
No, Sankit, you are a very good surgeon. You are a very good moderator also, and your questions are very. Your questions are also very much leading in one particular direction. But I have to tell you that where is hysteroscopy written as a part of the IVF procedure? That when you are doing,
we want your frank opinion, sir.
No need to do a hysteroscopy in a patient whom you are planning to do IVF, where the ultrasound findings are normal. Absolutely, there is no ambiguity in the answer to that question.
Okay.
However,
so to sum it up, may I say that IVF special in a case of IVF, in your opinion and of Dr. Pooja Mehta, Dr. Nilesh, and Dr. Sunil Shah, pre-IVF hysteroscopy need not be done simply because it is not required. And if your sonography findings are normal and you have yourself done the sonography, you are sure that hysteroscopy under no circumstances can yield anything else that is new. Is this correct, or any of you would like to add anything to this?
Absolutely. I think what we are discussing, like septum or polyp, everything can be diagnosed by a good 3D ultrasonography. And only thing which cannot be diagnosed, which comes after recurrent implantation failure, which we think after recurrent implantation failure, is chronic endometritis, which can be diagnosed possibly by hysteroscopy and by doing a bacterial assay.
Fine. Okay. So I would pose my next question in serial order again to Dr. Pooja Mehta. Madam, what is the role of ultrasound and how much is it accurate? I don't want percentages, but when you are doing your ultrasound yourself, could you say that you rely on it definitely and we do not require a hysteroscopy to confirm the findings?
See, Sanket, a very beautiful paper has been just published in 2019, which is a summary of so many RCTs and three retrospective and two prospective studies, and which has told statistically that yes, hysteroscopy is not required in a good 3D scan. Definitely this scan is very important where the blood flow, everything is seen properly. A Doppler three-dimensional ultrasonography, if it is done in a very proper way, we actually don't require a hysteroscopy routinely for all the IVF patients. Yes, hysteroscopy has to be done in majorly two cases where the patient is symptomatic. Definitely infertility is a symptom, but I would say it is an unexplained infertility. Or if the patient has a fibroid or has a pathology inside.
Any pathology.
Which will be diagnosed on an ultrasound, on a good 3D ultrasound. We are relying on a 3D ultrasound, definitely.
Fine.
At least I am relying very much on it.
Okay. So now coming back to Dr. Nilesh Balkavde, sir, you are somebody who is practicing ART as well as doing endoscopic surgeries. So do you think doing hysteroscopy per se has any beneficial effect on the IVF outcome? So we are talking about a patient who has everything normal inside, but still in your practice, you find that just doing the hysteroscopy makes her better receptive and increases her chances of getting pregnant. Is that something that you have seen, or do you think that this statement is no, it's not really valid?
I think so. This goes with the first question that routine pre-IVF hysteroscopy would have been recommended if this would have been the case. So if hysteroscopy would have definitely improved IVF outcome, we all IVF specialists would have done it definitely. But again, this comes only in cases of recurrent implantation failure. And you discussed about ultrasound versus doing hysteroscopy, any endoscopic technique for it. So we have ASRM guidelines for Mullerian anomaly, especially septum, which says that septum can be well diagnosed on by imaging techniques, and we don't need to go for a operative intervention like laparoscopy to confirm.
Absolutely.
So my say is that the answer is no to this.
Okay. Point.
Can I say 1 second? Like previously, when the era of 3D or MRI was not there, like we were not doing it routinely. Definitely, as Dr. Vimi or Dr. Sushila ma'am has told, we were doing hysteroscopy for all the patients. Yes, before. But now, since a few years, when good 3D scans are available, we are not doing it for sure.
Okay, fine. So let us see. What some papers and what at least some people feel is that there is a diagnosis of minor defects that were missed before. Stimulation of the endocrine, stimulation of the endometrium and release of cytokines, which is also called as endometrial scratching. And that is something that we are going to come to now. and making an embryo transfer easier in subsequent attempts due to cervical dilatation. So this is going a little bit with what Dr. Sushila Saini has said. Now let us look at the evidence before we move on to the next one. Again, evidence is to be taken in the light of your own expertise and not as a gospel truth. So don't jump on me if you feel that the evidence that is being projected is not correct. So I am going to talk about two studies. This first one is a study published in 2016, and this is, I think, by ASRM, the TROPHY study, in which they said outpatient hysteroscopy before IVF in women with a normal ultrasound and a uterine cavity, and even they have gone one step further to say, and a history of unsuccessful IVF treatment cycles does not improve the live birth rate. So this particular study, not in favor of hysteroscopy. And then again, something coming up in 2019, which said in women wishing to become pregnant spontaneously. So they have talked about spontaneous conception, not even IVF. Hysteroscopy was associated with a higher chance of an ongoing and clinical pregnancy rate. This is 2019 and this is Cochrane. In women undergoing IVF, the study suggested that performing a screening hysteroscopy first improved the chances of a live birth or clinical pregnancy. So this is what the evidence is saying now. We may or may not agree with it. There are other points ahead in the discussion, which personally I also don't agree with. But as a take-home message for the audience, if you are sure of your ultrasound findings, you will probably not go ahead with it. But if the ultrasound has been done by somebody else and you feel that there is a possibility of it being wrong, go ahead with a hysteroscopy to confirm that there is nothing that you are missing out. Let's talk about endometrial scratching. Dr. Vimi Bindra, may I start with you? You are doing endoscopic procedures, and when you're doing your own procedures, do you do this endometrial scratching procedure routinely in IVF patients, in patients who are undergoing IVF?
Usually, patients are referred to us by the consultants. So nowadays they request us to do that.
Correct. So just that's a very good answer. I did not want to ask, but request by consultant is something for which I am also doing a lot of endometrial scratching. So among your IVF consultants, madam, if you take 100 IVF consultants, how many would request you to scratch the endometrium of a normal looking patient?
Around 70%.
Excellent. Dr. Sushila Saini, madam, your yes and no to scratching, yes. And how much percent?
Yes, yes. And I think everybody normally says, okay, do something inside the cavity,
yeah,
like scratching.
And also get, do yeah. something inside the cavity.
Yeah.
But
that is the word actually doctor. They use, okay, do something, yeah. We get the result.
So Dr.
definitely Venu, they are happy also, okay, they get the result.
Yes, Dr. Venugopal, sir, is this doing something justified? Or are we unnecessarily doing needling for no reason?
See, we are doing hysteroscopy only in cases where there is recurrent implantation failure.
Okay.
So that is where the concept of this doing something arose, that something has to be done, and the scratch. So like all other things, the scratch we are doing, to tell you the truth. Now you ask for that, we do the scratch in recurrent implantation failure.
Okay.
But now if you ask that whether it is backed by a body of evidence, now the upcoming evidence is showing that it's an unnecessary procedure. So maybe at some point of time, we have to revise our thoughts regarding that.
Yes.
But practically, yes, because you need to do something, you know.
Exactly. Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam, what is your view on endometrial scratching? So by scratching, I mean either you just cut a little bit with the scissor, or some people are also using monopolar cautery. But that we are not going to be part of today's discussion. What is your view? Should endometrial this scratching be done, or is it not required?
See, frankly speaking, evidence kept apart, definitely we are doing scratching, and
excellent.
It is a good result. Definitely.
Excellent. Dr. Nilesh Malkavde, sir.
Endometrial scratching, actually, whenever we are putting in a scope, we have a habit of doing some scratching.
There you are.
So, I would recommend it is that we should do it only for cases of thin endometrium and cases of recurrent implantation failure.
Okay.
And one thing, care should be taken that we should not be causing adhesions. So we should not be going till the myometrium. So we
excellent.
Should be careful
yes.
while we are doing scratching.
Definitely.
Excellent point. Dr. Sunil Shah, sir, what is your take on it? Would you do endometrial scratching, or you feel not required so much? Sir, I've lost connection. Dr. Sunil Shah, sir? And Dr. Amit, can you check if sir is online?
I'm checking.
Connection is
I'm
mute.
Checking,
his connection is mute.
Nani, okay. Sir will have to unmute himself.
He's mute.
Sir, you are with
Sunil
us.
Shah, sir. Sunil Shah, sir, please unmute yourself. Please speak once, sir. We can see your phone is unmuted now.
Yeah. Hello. Yeah. What was the question? Sorry.
Sir, whether endometrial scratching, in your opinion, is something that should be done routinely for every patient or for some patients, or it is a not required procedure, unnecessarily doing something because we have done hysteroscopy?
See, it is, I am not doing it routinely, right? But in certain circumstances, I do use. When there is a more than two failure of IVF, I definitely go for it. And in that case, I don't do a scratching, but I do a office hysteroscope or a simple hysteroscope.
Okay.
And that can sometimes help, because as you rightly said, that it helps in producing cytokines and some kind of an inflammatory reaction into the endometrium.
Noted, sir. Point noted. Coming back to Dr. Vimi Bindra, madam, you must have done repeat hysteroscopies of patients in whom you did scratching before. And in your opinion, this scratching procedure, does it have a bad effect on the endometrium? Do synechiae develop later on, Dr. Vimi Bindra?
No, in my practice, I have not seen actually.
Fine.
So until unless they have any medical illness or repeated DNCs are done, usually Fine. The scratching which we do is very gentle.
Yes.
It's just stimulating the endometrium, so it doesn't cause adhesions.
Exactly. Dr. Sushila Saini, madam, same.
Yeah, we are doing with the scissors only and not using any electrode.
Excellent.
So it is actually not causing any difficulty.
Excellent. So fine. I think that that brings us to the end of diagnostic hysteroscopy for no defects. And now we are going to move on to question number two. Dr. Amit, are you ready with the question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, don't project it. First, I'm going to read it out. She's 30 years old, this lady, married since 6 months. She has accidentally detected a 7 millimeter sessile polyp at the fundus, and she has come for preconceptional counseling. And she has also come with her sister-in-law. Okay. Sister-in-law is also 30 years old. She's married since 2 years. She's unable to conceive. USG shows 7 millimeter sessile polyp at the fundus. Everything else is fine. And she has come for treatment of subfertility. So both of them have got similar type of polyps, but one is recently married and has come for preconceptional counseling, and other has come for treatment of infertility. My questions are whether X, first one, needs polypectomy, Y needs polypectomy, both need polypectomy, or neither needs polypectomy. Dr. Amit, can you please put the question on the screen? I hope you understood. First patient, 7 millimeter polyp, preconceptional counseling. Second patient, 7 millimeter polyp and infertility. Who requires polypectomy? The graph is fluctuating rapidly between options B and C. Okay, as we see it, the opinions are greatly divided between Y needs polypectomy and both need polypectomy. So we have 5 more seconds and then we will stop the poll. Okay, Dr. Amit, you can end the polling now. Right, can you show us the results also? Okay, so 7% have said X needs polypectomy, 51% Y needs polypectomy, 37% both need polypectomy, and 7% are neither needs polypectomy. This polypectomy and hysteroscopy thing is not required at all. Anyway, so let us start with, again, let's start right from the top. Venugopal sir, what is your opinion? Just pick a choice and then we'll discuss later on.
All right. So I will say that X doesn't need a polypectomy and Y needs a polypectomy.
Okay. Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam.
Yeah, the same as Dr. Venu, basically.
Okay. Dr. Yeah. Nilesh Balkavde.
Venu sir is my senior. I cannot disagree with him. So, same option.
Dr. Sunil Shah.
Same.
Okay. Dr. Vimi Bindra.
Y needs polypectomy.
Okay. And Dr. Sushila Saini.
Y needs. So Y definitely need actually polypectomy. X is like you can do if you are aapke haathon mein khujli hai, you can do
correct,
that.
Correct.
Ki finally, she may also need the polypectomy.
Okay, so now my question to all the panelists coming back one more time in serial order is, you want to do polypectomy for a 7 millimeter polyp because she's infertile, but you don't want to do polypectomy for a 7 millimeter polyp who is trying to get pregnant when removing the polyp will increase her chance of getting pregnant in the very next cycle. Why this disparity, Dr. Venugopal?
Yeah, as far as Mrs. X is concerned, now she's an accidentally detected 7 millimeter polyp, a subcentimetric polyp that has been accidentally detected. No symptoms as such. So that lady, it's possible that that you can wait. A little bit of conservative management can be advised. And say maybe after 2 or 3 months, if I repeat an ultrasound or so, it may not be there. But regarding the lady who has infertility, all other investigations are negative. And you arrived at a point where the polyp appears to be the only positive finding in your infertility. Fine. So even though it's a subcentimetric, in infertility patients, these polyps are hard to disappear, especially because it's sessile. So definitely, I think there should be no ambiguity as to why that should be removed and the other one be, you could have a conservative.
Fine. So I think Dr. Venugopal has answered it quite categorically and for all the panelists. So we are not going to pass this question around. Let's go directly to the next slide that we are talking about. Right. So, do all polyps need removal? I think Dr. Venugopal has already thrown some light on that all polyps do not need removal. But what I wanted to know is which polyps cause infertility. So, Dr. Pooja Mehta, depending on the size of the polyp and the location of the polyp, are there some polyps that you would say cause infertility? Some polyps do not cause infertility. So, I will remove these or I will not remove those. Or you will remove all of them or anything that any specific ideas that you may suggest. Dr. Pooja Mehta.
See, Sanket, it's like I would say definitely the location of the polyp is also very important and the size of the polyp is also very important. Mm-hmm. Location-wise, if I say if it is at the conwal end, maybe there is an occlusion. Sometimes polyp gives a feature of a SOL, that can definitely cause infertility. Okay. And plus one more thing of polyp is the reason of there are inflammatory reactions which occurs around the polyp. So that can again cause infertility. Okay. So definitely polyps location is very important because conwal end polyps are very important. And coming to the size of the polyp, yes, literature does say that less than 1 centimeter polyps can be left alone. But I don't know. We normally, if a patient is of infertility, we normally go ahead for a polypectomy. We do a hysteroscopic polypectomy. Whatever the size is.
Fine. Dr. Nilesh Balkavde, which polyps would you remove? And what is your take on what Venugopal sir said that a polyp of 7 millimeter may vanish in 3-4 months?
Yeah, so I agree with Venu sir that all polyps incidentally diagnosed, especially in that patient, which was only 6 months post her marriage, and that was the incidental diagnosis, will definitely wait and see if the polyp vanishes on its own. But all other polyps which are causing subfertility should be removed. That's what my my message would be. Especially the polyps near fundus. A small polyp, maybe less than 0.5 centimeter near the cervix can be left. But all those polyps at the implantation zone need to be removed. And any polyp before IVF should be removed. So if you are going for IVF, it should be removed.
Okay, so you have brought out another important point. A polyp in the implantation zone is a polyp that has to go before the patient tries pregnancy. Dr. Sunil Shah, sir, polypectomy before IUI, before IVF, only after failed IVF, or any infertility plus polyp means polypectomy? Sir, what is your opinion?
I don't go for polypectomy before IUI. I always try one attempt of IUI.
Okay.
If all other parameters are good, because less than 1 centimeter polyp has not caused many problems. So in IUI, considering a very simpler method, I always try one IUI. But all, even if it is 5 millimeter or 7 millimeter polyp, I remove it before IVF.
Fine. Okay. We will just take yes, no opinion from the other two panelists before we go on. Dr. Vimi Bindra, madam. What is your take? A 7 millimeter polyp patient has come to you she's maybe an incidental finding. Should it be removed or should it be left alone?
No, if it's the case of like Mrs. X, I would wait for some time.
Okay.
And if the same question for the Mrs. Y, it is the same question as before, like unexplained infertility.
Okay.
And we are doing a hysteroscopy and I find a polyp, I'll definitely remove it.
Okay. So now I will change the case scenario for you and especially for you and for Dr. Sushila Saini. Nothing was diagnosed before. You are doing office hysteroscopy. You put in office hysteroscope and now you see polyp. Will you remove it or will you leave it alone?
No, we will remove it.
You will remove it. Dr. Yeah, Sushila Saini, madam, what is your
I take? Also remove. If we are inside and we are seeing the polyp, then it should be definitely removed. It should
first
not
class.
Be
but
see and treat.
Yes, sorry. Go on.
See and treat, I said.
See and treat. Okay. So do you think that removing this polyp is going to damage the endometrium in any way?
No. We are do it very gentle way and with the scissors only and not using any cauterization. So it will not damage anything.
It's maybe similar to scratching actually, what we are doing.
Yes, definitely.
So does it, madam, Dr. Sushila Saini, madam, is there any chance of major complication like perforation or bleeding in this case?
Yeah, definitely. Maybe. Chance may be there.
Very less chance. Very less.
But it depends on the expertise and how orientedly you are doing the things.
Okay, fine. So we will take our final call as if you see a polyp during hysteroscopy, you remove it, but you don't keep the post the patient for polypectomy unless adequate trial at treating her infertility has already been done. Now coming back to the IVF specialists, this time we will start with Sunil Shah, sir. Sir, you have a patient and you are stimulating her and during the stimulation, a polyp develops. Now what to do? Cancel the cycle, let's say 1 centimeter polyp. Cancel the cycle, go ahead, how to go about now?
In this case, I will go ahead with the stimulation, I will complete the stimulation, I will do OPU, and then I will freeze all the embryos. Since it is a 1 centimeter polyp, I will not transfer.
Okay, embryos even if it has developed now. Fine, okay. What about Dr. Nilesh Balkavade, sir?
Yes, definitely. So, same answer as sir has told. We'll go for freezing and do a polypectomy and then a frozen embryo transfer.
Okay. Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam, you would like to do fresh embryo transfer for her or wait again after freezing?
No, definitely I will not do a fresh transfer. I would definitely do pick up. We are very proud of her vitrification. We'll do the vitrification of embryos. Next cycle, when the patient has, we'll do a hysteroscopy. Hysteroscopy will work both ways in this case. It will be working as a therapeutic and diagnostic both, you know,
fine.
Basically to see any other pathologies there and therapeutic where we remove the polyp and we also do endometrial scratching for that patient. And the result of the patient will be better if we do just hysteroscopy prior to the FET cycles. You know, I think that.
Noted. Dr. Venugopal, sir, how long does she have to wait till she tries her next cycle? She can do an immediate next cycle or 1 or 2 months she has to wait or I mean after polypectomy. After polypectomy, can you start her directly?
We go start her in the next, if she is desirous of transfer, yes, definitely. We don't wait after polypectomy.
Okay. Anybody in the panel in favor of waiting to allow endometrium to heal or something like that? Anything?
No.
Nobody. So everybody feels that you can directly go ahead.
In polypectomy, we don't expect much of an endometrial damage.
Correct.
It is like endometrial scratching only, no?
Yeah.
It is stimulating the endometrium.
One very good question has come from the audience. Will you do polypectomy at the time of ovum pickup?
Yes.
That is a very good question. And I think we can do polypectomy at the time of the pickup. It's a good idea. By that, we can avoid one anesthesia.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. I think that is a suggestion.
It can be done, but again, the endometrium will be overgrown. We have to remove the endometrium first and see exact location of polyp, because once a single polyp is there, there can be multiple polyps which can be missed. So this should be done with care. Yes, but it can be done.
Yeah. Exactly. I agreed with Dr. Nilesh. Definitely, we should wait, I feel.
Yeah, and
not a very good idea because polyp is usually not single. There might be multiple polyps, especially because it has developed during the stimulation. So there are high chances that the endometrium will be polypus and in fact it might grow further. So what we can do is we actually wait, we do the freezing and then afterwards if we do it just before the FET, it will get a better result.
Freezing is so much developed. I think that in the current era where vitrification and freezing is so good, we shouldn't...
Okay. So now coming back to the endoscopic surgeons quickly before we move on because we have a 1.5 hour deadline and it's almost 4. A lot of things are remaining. Let's start with Dr. Nilesh Balkavade. Hysteroscopic scissor or cautery? What is your choice?
Hysteroscopic scissors are always.
Okay. Dr. Sunil Shah, sir?
Scissor.
Scissor. Okay. Dr. Vimi Bindra and Dr. Sushila Saini, I'm not asking you. I just want to know, is there any place where you like to use the cautery? Or always scissor?
Mostly scissors. If it has a vascular stock or something where I'm expecting a bleeding, I might use a cautery or a laser.
Okay.
Or it may be a fibroid polyp, maybe they are, or a sessile polyp is the broad based polyp, and there's chances of bleeding, then we can use the resectoscope knife.
Okay, fine. Recurrence, I'm not going to discuss. So let's take a look at the evidence before we move on. current evidence does support, current means this is in 2015, supports the removal of endometrial polyps diagnosed prior to commencement of IVF cycles. So this is what everybody has said. And in conjunction with Dr. Venugopal, what sir said, that polyps which are more than 10 millimeter are unlikely to regress, but less than that, they may regress in 25% cases. Several large studies have shown a beneficial effect of hysteroscopic polypectomy, both prior to initial IVF and failed IVF. And like I think that, like Dr. Sushila Saini said, there may be an added benefit of the hysteroscopy itself because it facilitates the cervical dilatation and the embryo transfer, and the endometrial receptivity is increased by causing some endometrial injury. So this is again one more study which talks of what size of polyp is required to be removed. And frankly, surprisingly, they did not find any correlation between size. So they just looked at the position and they said removing polyps of even 5 millimeter is as effective as removing a polyp of 1 centimeter. 63% of patients would get pregnant after hysteroscopic removal of the polyp. So these are more studies. We are not going to talk about them. Significantly more cost effective compared to performing the hysteroscopy again. So we now move on to the next point. There is a slide flashing on our superstar screen. I would request all of the audience to look at the slide which is there on his television screen. And we are going to ask questions based on that particular slide. So this patient with this HSG report has a septate uterus, a subseptate uterus, an arcuate uterus, a bicornoid uterus. I need a sonography to confirm this. I need a hysteroscopy to confirm this. Or I need a laparoscopy plus hysteroscopy to confirm this. Dr. Amit, you are ready with the questions? We can flash on the screen.
Yes, sir.
Please do. Please scroll down for all options. There is some hesitation in the audience in voting for this particular question because the votes are coming in very slowly. Only 25% people have voted till now. It is anonymous, please. You can put whatever you feel like. Okay, so as it stands now, 22% say it is bicornuate, 30% say they need sonography, 50% want to do laparoscopy, hysteroscopy, 7% feel that it is septate. We can stop the polling now and see the results, please. Okay, so majority say we need laparoscopy plus hysteroscopy to confirm. If you all are seeing these results, then I can stop the polling and we can go. I can stop the slide and we can go on. Right. So let us see. I'm sorry. Screen is stuck. Yes, sir. So let's start one by one. Just a quick options review from all the panelists, and then we will go on. Starting with Dr. Sushila Saini this time. Madam, which option from these is your take?
It may be a septate or it may be bicornate, because HSG cannot confirm septate or bicornate. First thing. Second thing, we need a 3D sonography here. To confirm the diagnosis. It may be bicornuate or septate. It's definitely diagnosed by the 3D sonography or MRI. Excellent. And then we confirm it is bicornuate or septate. If it is septum, then we need the hysteroscopic septoplasty.
Yeah, that we were coming to, but just diagnosis. Dr. Vimi Bindra?
Same, I will need a 3D ultrasound to confirm. 3D ultrasound. Go ahead.
Dr. Sunil Shah?
It is a septate uterus or a subseptate uterus.
Okay. But sir, are you sure you do not want any other diagnostic modality before proceeding with the treatment?
Yeah, obviously I will need a 3D ultrasonography that will help me.
But you are sure it is septate, but you want to confirm by 3D?
It is surely a septate or a subseptate uterus. There is no doubt about it.
Absolutely. Dr. Nilesh Balkavde, sir.
So ASRM has given clear-cut guidelines for this definition, where I have to differentiate between arcuate uterus, septate uterus, and bicornuate uterus. So on the 3D ultrasonography, if we have an imaginary line or at the fundus,
coming to it,
and yeah, so we have a dimpling, then that's bicornuate uterus.
No, sir, your option, your choice among these.
I'll need a 3D ultrasonography.
Okay, right. Fine. Yeah. Dr. Pooja Mehta?
3D ultrasound, definitely.
Okay. Venugopal, sir?
It looks like a septate, but I need a surface contour evaluation to know in whatever way.
Yes, so excellently, what all the panelists have said in this discussion is that they want one particular investigation and they have insisted on a 3D ultrasound to make the diagnosis before they share. This was not one of the options only in the options, but this is what they wanted. So it looks like a septum, but what we need to know, is there a septum? So meaning that little dimpling, little more dimpling, little more than little more dimpling, how much dimpling is a septum? So we need to know the answer to the fact, is there a septum? And if there is a septum, whether the septum requires surgery or it does not require surgery. So let us see. So this patient now we are coming to, these are four different types of patients. 32 years old, married since 2 years, asymptomatic, USG showing whatever is, USG is showing two cavities, confirmed by HSG. Four separate HSGs are there in front of you. You are going to tell about each of these patients. So how to decide whether this patient requires surgery or not? I think this we discussed in the 3D ultrasound. So we are not going to talk about that much. If Dr. Venugopal, sir, could you said something about surface contour. Could you please explain that to all of us before we move on?
Yeah, the pictures that you've shown there, it's showing you exactly the surface. You can see the two ostia, the interosteal, you can see the interosteal distance, and from the surface to the first impression that is there. That is the one which gives us an idea whether it is a septate or a bicornate uterus.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Yes, sir. So I think what sir is saying is that in this picture, if you see this contour is smooth, but if you see this picture, this contour has dimpled down. So this is a bicornate uterus, and this is a septate uterus. From the inside, both look same, but from the top or the surface contour, they are different. And that is where the 3D helps you. So now, before we go on, just for the benefit of the audience, what Dr. Nilesh Balkavde was talking about. Dr. Nilesh, can you please explain in the light of this diagram what we are trying to say?
Yeah. So we have to differentiate between the arcuate septate uteri. So if the indentation below the fundus, if it is more than 1 centimeter, then only we'll be categorizing it as subseptate or septate. If it is less than 1 centimeter and the angle of that indentation is less than 90 degrees, it will be categorized as arcuate uterus. We may not operate arcuate uterus. We have to operate only subseptate and septate uterus.
Okay, so there are two schools of thought here, but the recent Cornuta classification, which has been published by the ESHRAE, says that on a 3D ultrasound, you draw a line from one ostium to the other ostium, which is seen here in blue. So you draw this line, and after drawing this line, you see how much of the septum projects below this line and how much is the uterine wall thickness above this line. And if the green arrow is more than 50% of the yellow arrow, then this patient has a septum and she requires surgery. So this is just for the benefit of the audience. Now, coming to our questions, let us start from Dr. Sunil Shah, sir. Sir, what do you feel? Does septum resection improve pregnancy rate and reproductive outcome?
Definitely, it improves the outcome. If patient is unable to conceive after all the trial, definitely septum resection improves the pregnancy rate.
Okay, fine. So given a patient who has got a septum and who has got infertility, you will definitely post the patient for septum incision by hysteroscopy. Correct, sir?
Correct. Absolutely. Correct.
First class. Let us go to Dr. Vimi Bindra and Dr. Sushila Saini. Dr. Vimi Bindra, does septum resection improve pregnancy rate and reproductive outcome? Yes or no?
Yes. Definitely.
Sushila Saini, madam?
Yeah, definitely.
Yes, madam. No controversy. Let's see Dr. Venugopal, sir.
When you talk about pregnancy rates, even with septum patients, they conceive. Okay. But when it comes to the reproductive outcome, then the incision of the septum makes a difference in terms of outcomes.
Could you explain that more clearly, sir? We did not understand. Pregnancy rate and reproductive outcome means what?
Yeah, because ladies with septum, they tend to show increased amount of pregnancy loss in terms of first trimester pregnancy losses, even mid-trimester pregnancy losses. So that all together contributes to that total outcome. But they do become pregnant. Many often you find patients with septum becoming pregnant, don't you? You do find them becoming pregnant. And a few of them, they continue to deliver also.
Okay. So at what stage, Dr. Pooja Mehta, at what stage do you think this phenomenon happens? So with a septum, is it that you get a just chemical pregnancy, or do you get an early first trimester pregnancy and there is a loss? Or at what stage does the loss happen in your practice?
See, first of all, septum, if I start saying about it, it is a canalization defect, basically. So the reproductive outcome, as Dr. Venu has said, ki it is less. But I would say there are chances of infertility also. Okay. And definitely, if you talk of recovery outcomes, the abortions are usually later abortions. You know, it starts from 8 weeks to further abortions. You know, are okay. Usually there.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So, in your opinion, also septum resection improves both or only improves reproductive outcomes?
It improves both the infertility both. And the okay. reproductive outcomes.
Dr. Nilesh Balkavde.
Yes. So septum resection, septum will itself cause infertility as well as it will affect the reproductive outcomes. That's what Dr. Pooja told rightly. And so it should be treated. And second thing is that sometimes there can be mid-trimester losses as well because there are connective tissue abnormalities. So these patients, after we are doing septum resection, we should put a cervical cerclage. That's my opinion. However, there may be difference of opinion for cervical cerclage.
Yes.
But that's my opinion.
Okay, fine. So now we'll start with you only. In fact, what is your opinion about scissor, cautery and laser? Which one do you use?
Personally, I'm using scissors for doing this, but whenever it is a broad based septum, we may anticipate that there can be a bleeder in that broad base where, as we are going towards the fundus. So we should keep cautery ready, but otherwise most of the septum can be removed, incised by scissors, and we need not excise the septum, we can just incise it.
Okay, fine. In the patients that you have done, does it matter, do patients operated with cautery have more adhesions?
Few of my patients have operated by cautery. Even if I encounter bleeding, I just increase the pressure so that the bleeder disappears. We hold the pressure, higher pressure for some time, and then again decrease the pressure to the normal whatever pressure we are using. So I'm not using cautery that much, but however, we have not encountered any adhesions with the use of cautery as well.
Fine. Coming to Dr. Sunil Shah, sir, earlier you did not think that there is a septum, but now you are doing the hysteroscopy and you can see that there is a septum. Now, very difficult to measure it inside. Now, 3D ultrasound is not possible, but you can see. So, not this picture. This picture is a very frank septum, but something less than that. And it's difficult to say, you know, whether this is arcuate or this is subseptate or what, but there definitely is a projection which is separating the two ostia. Sir, you would cut this septum or you would leave it alone? Dr. Sunil Shah, sir?
I think Dr. Shah is busy.
Okay. Meanwhile, we will go with Dr. Vimi Bindra. This septum, you will cut it or you will leave it alone? Not this one. This is just a representational picture. You get what I'm saying? We have gone inside. There is some elevation, you know. So it is not entirely clean cut, squeaky clean, normal cavity, which IVF specialists usually want. They want perfect cavity. It is not perfect cavity. There is something. Maybe subseptum or somewhere. You will cut it or you will leave it alone?
Yes, I will cut it, and till I can see both the ostia and one plane, I'll like to create a good cavity for the, if she's going for IPF. Definitely, okay. I'll cut it.
Sushila Saini, madam?
Yeah, I will cut it because it's a part of like fundal necking now, which we are doing in a scratching, like lateral scratching, lateral necking and fundal necking. So fundal necking is like that only, cutting the subseptum or like a fundal depression may be there. So we are cutting and seeing the both the ostia at the same level.
Okay. So now we will go to the opposition party. Venugopal, sir. Sir, do you think that cutting this septum is going to cause a lot of problem to this patient? She will have synecdoche. And why to do all this unnecessary procedure?
No. Once you have seen the septum there when you are operating on it, it's better to cut it because it's known it's having... Okay. Adverse reproductive outcomes. So I think there is no opposition with that regard to that.
Okay. So, sir, what you are saying?
We are not opposing parties.
No. We are working simultaneously. Venugopal, sir, what you are saying is that if you have diagnosed a septum prior and it is a subseptate uterus, you need not cut it. But when you are already doing the hysteroscopy and you have seen the septum, now it is not wise to leave it alone. You might as well give it an incision and cut it off. Is that, are we in agreement on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think.
Okay, fine. So this, I think Dr. Nilesh talked about, if anybody of you have more experience, because this is not a commonly done thing.
Can I just add to the previous thing?
Sure.
I said ki, first of all, whenever we are doing a procedure, we are actually thoroughly investigating a patient before a hysteroscopy. So that chances of an incidental finding on a hysteroscope is very rare. I feel we are going to do a 3D scan of a patient beforehand and then go ahead. You know, I feel that. But anyways, yes.
No, it is not very much rare.
Sorry?
The first
not,
time.
No, it is not very much rare, actually. It is quite common. Actually, we are finding the surprises in the uterine cavity.
That's what I said. We will thoroughly investigate a patient before going ahead for an invasive procedure.
Agree,
being an invasive procedure, I'm going to investigate it thoroughly with a good 3D scan and then only go ahead for a hysteroscopy.
The gray zone, madam, is that not everybody does a thorough investigation, and sometimes when you are doing the procedure and it is somebody else has worked up the patient before you, you find this on the table. But anyway,
yes,
we are not going to get into those discussions.
Okay.
End block excision of septum or only incision of septum, this is a surgical technicality. But any of you has anything to say regarding this specifically, or we will skip it entirely? Dr. Nilesh, you were mentioning something.
I think in the initial days, some people were doing end-block excision, but nowadays incision is what everyone is recommending and doing. I don't know any recent procedure for doing this.
Sometimes I see, you know, when the septum is very large and a broad septum, and when you incise it, then there's this overhanging when that is there, I think then that is when you try and excise that, because otherwise you know, the risk of that thing again, this thing and reforming. I think that's what I have seen from.
That we can put a Foley's maybe, or give a good estrogen support, so that endometrium overgrows that part.
Coming to that, sir. So we are going to talk about adhesion prevention a little later. But so we are clear on. So suppose what you are saying is that if there is a complete septum or a large septum, then it might be a good idea to excise a part of it to ensure that it doesn't stick back. Now, let us look at what the evidence says, and a lot of you may not agree. Even I do not agree to some of the points that are there in the evidence, but this is recently published evidence, and believe me, it is very high quality evidence. So let us see what it says. The ASRM says that there is insufficient evidence to conclude that a uterine septum is associated with infertility. And in the same guideline, in the same published guideline, there is a second point which says that several observational studies indicate that hysteroscopic septum incision is associated with improved clinical pregnancy rates in women with fertility. So point A says that you don't cut it, and point B says that you cut it. If I were to be doing the surgery and if it was my patient personally, I would cut it. But that is my opinion. It may or may not be valid. There is fair evidence that a uterine septum contributes to miscarriage and preterm birth. So the guideline categorically states that as far as miscarriage is concerned, they are concerned about miscarriage, and therefore it will correct miscarriage. So the take-home message would be from this guideline, at least, that if you see the septum, you cut it. If it is not going to help in infertility, at least it will help her to not miscarry when she has the pregnancy. But coming a little further to a little more recent evidence, this is Cochrane 2017, and they have said that there is no evidence to support the surgical procedure of septum resection in these women at all. Please, again, this is not my finding. This is an international RCT. So you like it or not, this is what the evidence has to say. And more recent than this is this landmark paper, which has just come out in 2020. So take a look at what this paper is saying. This is an international multi-center cohort. They have studied patients over 8 years, from January 2000 till 2018. And 257 women have been studied across 21 different centers in different countries. And if you look at the two lines, the top line is the adjusted cumulative live birth rate with expectant management. And the bottom line is the same group of patients. So they have actually not done anything in 50% patients, and they have done septum excision in 50% patients. And they have said that the adjusted cumulative live birth rates are more or less the same, and therefore they do not recommend septum excision or septum incision as a valid procedure at all. Again, something that I do not agree with personally in my practice, but then I leave the opinion to your good faith. So let the last slide before we move on to the next problem is that the answer to not cutting the septum and to not excising the septum or to do nothing with the septum may lie in this paper, which is published in JMIG. And they have said that they have actually taken biopsies from the septum core and the septum apex. And they have said that in the apex, the tissue which is there is like a fibroid. So it is not only fibrous tissue, it is fibromuscular tissue. And that the septum is not the I-shaped septum that we used to think of before, but it is an H-shaped septum, which is in merged with the uterine tissue. And therefore, excising this whole septum may not be required and may actually be harmful. So this is what the recent evidence has to say. Let's go on now to question number 4. And we are going to again look at the image which is there on our superstar screen. Take a look at this image properly. I'm going to ask you questions based on this image, and even our superstar is worried, kya kare is uterus ka? So for this particular uterus, do you think hysteroscopic lateral metroplasty is really required for this uterus, which is seen on the screen now? Yes, it will improve fertility. So by fertility, I mean the conception rate. Yes, you will do surgery. So you will do hysteroscopic lateral metroplasty, but because it will reduce the abortion rate, not the conception rate. Or yes, it will do both. Or no, it's an overrated surgery and causes more damage by inducing adhesions. Dr. Amit, can we have the questions on the screen? Dr. Amit, you are with us? Yes, please. Yeah, so the voting lines are open. Fastest finger first. Right, 71% are now thinking as of now that it is an overrated surgery. That is something to think about. But wait, no, figures are changing. Yes, it will do both is 30%. We have 5 seconds more before we stop the polling. And can you stop the polling now? And show us the result. More than half of people believe that hysteroscopic lateral metroplasty is a useless procedure and it is only going to cause damage by inducing adhesions. So let us start. We will start with Venugopal, sir. Sir, your face is flashing on the screen in my, this thing at least. So we will start with you. What is your take, sir? Which of the four?
There should have been a fifth option to agree to disagree with all of these.
No, sir, there is no option. You can give me what your opinion is. You are exempt from these options.
No, the option, the answer is that I wouldn't call it an overrated surgery if it is done in indicated patients.
Okay.
That's my answer. That's so because
patient is infertile. She's got 2 years of infertility and this is the HSG.
Yeah, pure infertility is it's the last option because no, just for infertility. If it's bad obstetric history in terms of missed abortions or pregnancy losses, okay, then I would consider that.
So this is a patient, so we'll move on to the next panelist. Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam, this is a patient who has got only 2 years of infertility. You want to do lateral metroplasty or no? No recurrent losses.
In fact, I would do a minimal lateral, because it is a T-shaped uterus, definitely. Metroplasty, bilateral lateral metroplasty would definitely help in improving the outcome of fertility.
Okay, so like, so you want to do lateral metroplasty?
Yeah.
Dear Sankit sir,
yes, sir.
We have Kedar sir with us.
Take a minute. Yes, yes, we will halt the discussion. Welcome, Kedar sir.
Hello, Amit, I am not seen.
Amit? Sir, you are seen on the screen.
Yeah. Can you share my slides, please?
Yes.
I am not able to see him.
Sir, please stop your slides share.
Okay, sorry. I have stopped sharing, yes.
Okay, we are sharing sir's slide. Give me a minute. Can you all see Kedar sir on the screen?
Yeah, hello. Yes. Yeah, first of all, I would like to thank the panelists and the moderator and MQR Pharma to conduct this wonderful webinar. On behalf of Team ISAR, Dr. Prakash Trivedi and myself. Can I have the next slide, please? So I wanted you all to, this year we are trying to propagate our esteemed journal, JSRS, which has a very good impact factor. and there is no processing fee. So when you want to submit a publication related to human fertility, reproduction, infertility, please think about JHRS journal. Next slide, please. And also, we are trying to promote the virtual accreditation process. Now the ISAR has undertaken, which is without a visit. First visit, your center can get accredited with ISAR. All the details are provided here. Anybody needs further details, one can contact ISAR office and we will be able to give you all the details. Thank you very much, Sanket Prasad, and thank you very much, Amit, and the panelists for giving me this opportunity to speak in between. Please continue the panel discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Kedar sir, for your inputs, and I hope you will stay with us for the remainder of the discussion and provide some valuable inputs to management and probably generate some more controversy also, so that the discussion becomes more interesting. I am now
as far as the T-shaped uterus is concerned, I would do the uterine volume on the day when the size of the follicle is 18 to 20, and if this volume is less than 2 ml, I would think of doing a lateral metroplasty.
Okay, we will come to that. And for now, I think one of the participants, I could not see the screen before, but now I could see the chat comments, and one of the participants, Dr. Kamlesh Mishra, sir, has raised a question. First of all, is it a T-shaped uterus, he's asking. We are also going to come to that. But first, we'll take up the rest of the panelists. Dr. Nilesh Balkavde, what is your opinion, sir?
I was going to comment on similar lines, that it doesn't appear to be a classic T-shaped uterus where the lateral walls are narrow and we couldn't see the ostia. So if we put it in a hysteroscope, and if you are able to see the ostia, just if we go proceed the internal os, then we may not do a lateral metroplasty in those cases.
Okay. So you will base your, so even on this side, even on the right side of the screen, you feel that this indentation is not sufficient. You will be able to see the ostia from here? I don't think there is a very large projection.
It's somewhere between a T and a inverted triangle. So inverted triangle is what we expect, but that's not a classical picture of T-shaped uterus where I will go immediately for lateral metroplasty. However, I will place my diagnosis on what Kedar sir said, that if the uterine volume at the time of the follicle size maturity is less, then I would go in for a lateral metroplasty.
Fair enough. Sunil Shah, sir? Yeah. Sir, we've lost connection with
you. Sorry. Hello? I'm there.
Yes, sir.
I am also not agreeing with this. It doesn't look like a typical T-shaped uterus.
Perfect. Okay.
Right. But okay. And I also agree with Dr. Venugopal. In case of a recurrent abortion or recurrent premature deliveries, this metroplasty has to be done. Otherwise, it should be avoided, because the size of the uterus or the capacity of the uterus is small in case of a T-shaped uterus. And it has to be done only in case of a recurrent abortion or a recurrent premature deliveries.
Okay, so now before I proceed to Dr. Vimi Bindra and Dr. Sushila Saini, my question back to Dr. Sunil Shah sir and to Dr. Venugopal, why do we actually want to wait till she has an abortion if we can see a defect?
See why we want to wait, because many a time uterus expands well. After conception, it is a tremendous power to expand and to accommodate the baby. So we want nature, how that nature reacts to that particular baby. For that, we need to wait for that. That is what my answer is.
Okay, point noted. Venugopal, sir.
People are asking about the shape, right? Again, in the T also, I think there's some of them look like a Y. It's not always a classic T. Some of them look like a Y, and some of it is cylindrical like an I. See, this is the one where we would like to wait, because centrally there's some space for the cavity to expand, like what Shastra was saying. But if it were a classic T or maybe an I, then like Sanket says, I would think of going ahead and do and not wait for an adverse obstetric outcome because of this thing. Okay. And that differentiation is, you have to differentiate based on that. I think there's a good article in Fertility and Sterility about that one.
Yes.
They're not T always.
Okay. So let's going on to now Dr. Vimi Bindra and Dr. Sushila Saini. Madam, before you operate, Dr. Vimi Bindra, how would you like to confirm the diagnosis of T-shaped uterus? Is HSG good enough? You want 3D USG, or you will make your final diagnosis on table and then decide and cut? Dr. Vimi Bindra.
Most of the time, these patients come with the HSG report to us. Mm-hmm. And we can see the cavity. And anyways, we are posting her for hysteroscopy if it is a planned one. And if mm-hmm. I find there is a lateral convergence, definitely mm-hmm. I'll go for the lateral metroplasty. One more thing, if we show the HSG to the patient and we tell her that it looks like there is some problem with the walls,
mm-hmm.
and we are going to wait till you miscarry and then we'll do the procedure.
Mm-hmm.
So usually our Indian population doesn't accept that. So, okay, so here we go a little more aggressive, and then yes, we are doing it.
So you will go by your subjective diagnosis that you make in the OT based on your knowledge of how the cavity generally looks like in a normal yes. patient. Dr. Sushila Saini, madam, what is your...
No, I am not agree with this. I will go for definitely first 3D ultrasound and okay. see the thickness of the lateral walls.
Mm-hmm.
So and exactly the diagnosis should be confirmed before... attempting the hysteroscopy, and we have to decide how much we have to lateral necking we have to done, because the okay. thickness of the uterine wall is actually major. Ki mujhe pata hona chahiye ki mujhe 1 cm neck karna, half cm neck karna, how much I should and how much thickness of the wall, and it should be T-shaped cavity, then it should be done.
Okay.
As fine. A part of lateral necking, we can do something if the conversion of walls is there, a little bit like scratching or lateral necking and fundal necking we are doing.
Hmm.
But exactly for correction of cavity, we have to need first 3D ultrasound and exact thickness of the uterine walls.
Okay, definitely. Point noted. I think we will have to go a little faster. Yes, please.
Can I add one point? That yes, we should. We can also diagnose these cases. Sometimes we have thin endometrium cases, especially with history of POPs prior. So these patients will also show thin endometrium sometimes, and they'll show classical T-shaped uterus. So we have to remember that along with the lateral metroplasty, we have to send EBPCR or any investigation for endometrial cops in this kind of patients who have classical T-shaped uterus.
What is your take, Dr. Nilesh? What is your take, scissor or cautery?
Scissor again I'm using for this. No
scissor cautery. You are using. Dr. Sunil Shah, sir? Scissor or cautery?
I think he left.
Sir left, right.
Sir will join back. Dr. Vimi Bindra, just scissor or cautery?
Scissors. If it is a fibromuscular, then yes, I might use cautery.
Okay.
Mostly preferable is scissors.
No, actually, on the lateral wall, scissors are a little bit difficult and we cannot actually cut the so much deep we want. So, I generally use the Collins knife on cutting current. So, okay. we can exactly give the nick which I want, actually half centimeter or 1 centimeter.
Okay. You would prefer to use scissor. Now, we just go on to the quick review before we go to the next question. So, like Dr. Sushila Saini said, one of the most reliable indicators is the 3D ultrasound. And they measure the isthmic diameter in yellow and the interosteal diameter in blue. And I think the ratio is about 1.5 times. If that is there, then you can call it as a T-shaped uterus. So, yes. you can diagnose beforehand before you go in with the surgery. And again, what is the effectiveness of a lateral metroplasty? They have said that lateral metroplasty increases the volume of the uterus from a mean of 2.5, this is what Dr. Kedar was saying, to 3.2, and very good reproductive outcome as far as recurrent implantation failure, recurrent pregnancy loss, but also a very good outcome as far as unexplained infertility is concerned. So definitely a procedure which requires to be done if the indication is there and if the diagnosis is made on 3D ultrasound. So more recent evidences from the European Journal have shown a statistical significant increase in live birth rate, a decrease in miscarriage rate, 49% of spontaneous pregnancies after doing simply T-shaped uterus correction. So definitely a procedure, but the diagnosis has to be correct. Now let's move on to the next pathology. I think we have two more pathologies left before we end this discussion. Right. So there is a patient. She is 30 years old. She is infertile. USG, there is a sonography report. I'm going to show you the film. It says there is a 4 centimeter submucous fibroid that displaces the endometrium. Okay. patient wants it removed without scar on the abdomen. For those of you who are very good at sonography, you do your own sonography. For those of us who are not, we see, rely on the reports that are sent to us from the sonography center. But this patient, I am going to show you the film. This particular patient, wants it removed without scar on the abdomen. And you, first option, you promise her that you can do it by hysteroscopy. You are confident, you are excellent hysteroscopic surgeon. You can remove the entire fibroid by hysteroscopy. Second option, you refuse, saying that this fibroid needs to be removed by laparoscopy. Third option, you will try by hysteroscopy, but may require laparoscopic assistance. This is the sonography picture. This is the fibroid. Okay? This is the sonography picture. This is the fibroid. This is actually not 4 centimeters, but consider it 4 centimeters for the sake ease of discussion. And now may we have the questions on the screen, please? Dr. Amit, what does the audience feel? You promise her you can do it hysteroscopically. You refuse, it has to be removed laparoscopically. And you will try by hysteroscopy, but you will need laparoscopic assistance. We have 10 seconds more before we close voting. Vimi madam, if you could just keep looking at the chats, if there is a
I have written almost 7-8 questions.
If there is a question that has to be urgently addressed, we'll raise it. We'll see it now.
Okay. Just now, Dr. Sandesh Kade has asked a question.
Yes.
Will panel do metroplasty on a hypoplastic small uterus?
Okay. Excellent question. We'll take it up just at the end of this.
Because it is related to the previous discussion.
Yes. 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 Okay. We can close the poll now. 77% want to try by hysteroscopy, but will need laparoscopic assistance. I think that is sitting on the fence, not deciding. But anyway, let us see. Let's start again from Dr. Sushila Saini this time. Madam, what is your take?
Actually, I need again a 3D sonography here.
Okay.
Because actually the volume of the fibroid is matters in the hysteroscopic resection. Because it's not a 4 centimeter. It should be like how much volume, like transverse diameter, how much deep inside, and grading of the fibroid also needed. Grade 0, grade 1, or grade 2.
But madam, here we can see this is type 2.
Yeah.
Half in, half out.
Yes.
So for
yes.
this particular fibroid, what is, which one you will...
I will try with the hysteroscopy only, because this grade 2 can be removed with the hysteroscopy. But right. there may be a chances to take help of laparoscopy. So we cannot promise exactly we will do it 100% in one setting with the hysteroscopy.
Okay,
if purely fine. We are doing the hysteroscopically, then we have to may take the two setting,
may.
It depend on the during
point
the
noted.
Search.
Point noted. Dr. Vimi Bindra.
Yeah, I'll tell them that mostly I'll be doing it hysteroscopically, but at any point of time, she might need laparoscopy.
Hmm.
And if hysteroscopically done, sometimes two sittings may be needed if fluid overload.
Time, sorry to cut you off. Any point of time means for a complication or otherwise?
If it is a 4 centimeter fibroid, it can be done in one sitting. But if there is no fluid overload or any other complication.
Okay.
If any point we feel that fluid overload is happening or any other problems due to hysteroscopy, we might schedule her for the second setting. But I'll take her consent for the second setting as well.
Okay. Sunil Shah, sir.
Sunil Shah, sir, is not there.
Oh, okay. We will take Dr. Nilesh Balkavade's opinion.
Yeah, so if fibroids are more than 2 centimeter and if they are type 2 fibroids, always the patient should be counseled that the time might increase for the case and she may have to go for a laparoscopy in case there is perforation. Although less likely if we are well versed with hysteroscopy, but a second stage procedure should always be counseled because that's what literature also says. If the fibroid is at an odd location or if the size is more, according to the LASMAR classification or step W classification, if it is a complicated surgery, you should always counsel for a two-step procedure before going ahead and landing up in trouble on table.
Okay. Okay, fine. We'll just take a quick opinion from Venu Gopal sir and Pooja Mehta madam before we go on. Venu Gopal sir, what is your take on this?
Yeah, we'll try hysteroscopy, mainly laparoscopic surgery.
Okay. Pooja Mehta, madam?
The same, yeah. We would definitely try hysteroscopically. But a consent for a laparoscopy is must in case of complications. That's very important.
Okay. Somehow, if I were a panelist, I would not agree to this. But anyway, we will see it later on. Let's complete the discussion first. Stuck. Sorry. Right. So, let's see, this is another patient. I think we will discuss this part before we move on. The reason I said that personally I would not agree is that first, a 4 centimeter submucous myoma is a very large myoma and the chances of causing a fluid overload are high. Secondly, in a 4 centimeter myoma, you are going to try to scrape out the myoma from completely within the uterine cavity and you're going to do a lot of denuding of the endometrium. So if I were to have an option, I would do it laparoscopically, cut from here, take out the fibroid, not touch the endometrium and give her a good endometrium in the next cycle. But that is my way of looking at it. I believe the panel does not agree, but we will keep it at that. So moving on to submucous fibroids, Sandesh sir, if you are listening, we are going to take your question, but we are running little short of time and yours is the first question that we will address as soon as our panel is done. We should be done in 20 minutes more. So this patient, 30-year-old, no complaints, incidentally detected, 1.5 centimeters, anterior wall fibroid, type 2. So again, 50% in the cavity, 50% outside. Everything else is basically the same. Only the size of the fibroid has changed. Does she need surgery? Starting with Dr. Venugopal, sir.
She is not a case of infertility. She has no complaints.
She has, sir. So no complaints means she is infertile. All patients in this panel are infertile.
Yes. Then it be removed because submucous fibroid has adverse outcomes.
Fair enough.
There's no doubt. No doubt.
Yeah, if the patient is infertile, definitely we'll go ahead for a hysteroscopic removal of the fibroid.
Point noted. Nilesh Balkavde, sir.
Again, yes, same answer.
Same answer. Anybody does not want to remove the fibroid?
No.
Everybody has the same answer. Fine. So I think we'll take it as a take-home message that any submucous fibroid has to go. What is the lower limit of size then that must be removed? Sunil Shah, sir, I don't know if you are still connected with us or not.
No.
He said he's leaving. He said bye and all.
Okay, fine. So Dr. Vimi Bindra, madam, is there a lower limit of size? So 0.5 centimeter submucous fibroid. Still you want to remove?
Anything interfering with the endometrial cavity has to go.
Even 0.5 centimeter.
Yeah.
Like polyp also.
So we are removing 7 millimeter polyp also, right?
Okay. Sushila Saini, madam?
Yeah. Like polyp we are removing, so then fibroid why should be there?
Has to go.
Fibroid
has to be go because fibroid actually the TGF beta and many chemicals it is.
Not only that, the fibroid, polyp, all of these have been studied and shown that they affect implantation. They alter the implantation gene. So
absolutely.
I think we should not have a Rakow study showed in polyp that, you know, implantation is altered. So I think we shouldn't think about it.
Absolutely. So in a fibroid, size is not a question. If there is a submucous fibroid or anything indenting the endometrium, that has to go. Upper limit that can be removed by hysteroscopy. Dr. Sushila Saini, madam, 3 centimeter, 4 centimeter, 5 centimeter. Let's consider type 2 only. Where will you say, ki bas enough, now I want to do lap?
Mera bas chala tha na sare lap hi karna. I do not do the hysteroscopy.
Nahi, for audience, madam, for audience. Standard skilled person. Not like very highly skilled person like you.
Like 3 centimeter, I will go comfortably with the hysteroscopy. And above than 3, I will do... and my personal like you only, I am also always thinking when we remove the hysteroscopically myoma, we resect out first the endometrium, then we take out the myoma. But actually, when we are doing the laparoscopically, or jara sa agar endometrium ka nick lag gaya, endometrium open ho gaya, to pata nahi high to bar jata hai ki endometrium open ho gaya, endometrium open ho gaya. Then the question is not coming ki hysteroscopically jab aap nikal rahe ho, to there is no damage to the endometrium. And then laparoscopically you are doing and just opening the cavity, like nicking in the cavity is like you have damaged the endometrium. So this is, I want to ask the IVF experts.
Point noted. Yeah. So what specific counseling, I think we've already talked about fluid overload and all that. And we've also talked about laparoscopy at the same time. So now monopolar versus bipolar resection, Dr. Nilesh Balkavde, which one you are using and you feel there is any difference as far as patient safety is concerned?
So we are almost 100% shifted on bipolar and use of normal saline. We are not using glycine and monopolar current in our practice. With bipolar, the current delivery is a little bit slow and the cutting effect is a little bit slow. But if you put on higher settings, it will give you a easy cutting with bipolar. But saying so, it will add to the time of your surgery, but it will prevent the risk of TUR syndrome in patients especially with use of glycine, we have that syndrome. So if we shift from normal saline and bipolar current, that's the thing to talk about now.
Fair enough, fine. So now let's look at what the evidence says before we go on. Cavity distorting myomas, intramural with a submucous component, myomectomy improves pregnancy rates. Non-cavity distorting myomas may not improve pregnancy rates, and submucous fibroids definitely improves clinical pregnancy rates. So any submucous fibroid has to go. Let's now move on.
Coming to Dr. Sushila's question, ma'am was saying ki, why are we worried about the endometrial neck? You know, like if at all the endometrium is, during the laparoscopy, if at all the endometrium is open. The main thing is, ma'am, I think the stitch which we are taking. So we are more worried if the stitch goes through the endometrium. Na? That is that's the reason we do a relook hysteroscopy after, say, 2 or 3 months, and then we see if there is any stitch inside. You know, that's the reason I think so we are worried. Otherwise, so that is okay. Endometrium is regenerated.
So should we do not stitch the endometrium separately? Should we do not, if we are opening the endometrial cavity is opened, and should we repair it, not to repair, we should leave it as such without repairing, or we are taking the suture on the myometrium only?
I think a good laparoscopic surgeon can answer this very well, very well. Dr.
No. Actually, we can suture, but IVF expert will tell you, should we do or not to do?
See, in the endometrium, definitely there should be no foreign body. That's very important. You know?
If the endometrium is open, as you said, madam, the chances of adhesion formation is high. What Sushila madam said is right. So, but there is no literature available whether the suturing will be effective or not.
Exactly.
So, saying so, you have to take a decision at that moment of time.
So most of us,
because we are taking subendometrial sutures, we are just suturing, approximating the endometrium, not taking through and through suture. So it because endometrium is again a regrow definitely.
Yeah.
Not like it's so sutured. What I personally do in my cases.
General consensus is that you suture the myometrium over the endometrium. Do not let the suture pass through the endometrium. The endometrium will heal on its own. But if the suture goes through the endometrium, it will definitely cause adhesions.
Yes.
Sanket, one more school of thought for this treating submucous fibroids is that if we see the literature coming up from Betocci and Harnovich, who are considered the fathers of hysteroscopy there. So if we consider their literature, they are following a two-step technique of treating the submucous fibroids. They are just doing a laser around the fibroids, so that will be preventing the blood flow to the fibroid. And then in the second look surgery, they are doing the myomectomy part of it. So once you do the laser and decrease the blood flow of the fibroids will itself shrink, and then the second look surgery will be easy. On the same lines, I had presented a paper in Maharashtra chapter of ESAR where I did the same thing with scissors. So that is another option where you can use in cases of large submucous myomas.
Yes. So what they are actually also doing, particularly Professor Betocci, is to make an incision circumferential around the fibroid and just leave the patient alone for 3 months. You will find that after 3 months, the fibroid which was type 2 now pops into the cavity and becomes type 0, and removal is much more easier.
Yeah.
But now going on to the next pathology. So this is the next slide which is projecting on our actor's screen. And he's urging you to look at the slide and take a decision as to what is to be done about this particular case. So in case of intrauterine synecdoche, this is actually a fairly simple question, but let's see what the audience feels. What do you think is the most important cause? Tuberculosis, PID, previous MTP, so surgical abortion, previous medical abortion, or a previous surgery like septum resection or myomectomy? Dr. Amit, can we start the poll? Opinion as of now is divided between TB and MTP. Okay, and we can stop now. Okay, 54% say MTP, 36% tuberculosis, and 10% previous surgery like septum resection or myomectomy. Okay, so let us now see what our experts have to say. We are not going to discuss this point much because it is not of much consequence. Let us directly go to the treatment part of it. And it is not of much debate that a patient who has got intrauterine synechiae requires hysteroscopy and the synechiae have to be removed. So we are not really going to talk about that. What we are going to talk about is the dubious variant, which is not seen clearly. So let me start with Dr. Venugopal, sir. Sir, thin ET always means synechiae, or in what percent of cases in your practice?
Yeah, you have to take into perspective where you're practicing. For example, where I am practicing in down south, thin ET does not always mean synechiae. It's more likely to be a severe form of PCOD or something like that. And synechiae for us will come second in order. And then the etiology for synechiae will not be tuberculosis first. It's more likely to be either a post-abortal or a post-infectious and that kind of etiology. So I think you have to take it in that perspective. We won't think of synechiae first. We always think of something like PCOD or something like that. So I think everybody will have a different perspective regarding that.
Fair enough, fair enough. Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam, your first line of treatment, thin endometrium again. So this one on top, not somebody who is classically showing HS synechiae on HSG, but just the thin endometrium. No, 3-4 millimeter. What will be your first line treatment? Post her for hysteroscopy or try with estradiol valerate? Dr. Pooja,
unmute yourself.
Have we lost connection?
Yeah. Sorry, I just got it. Okay. So I said it depends on what I'm doing basically. If it is a patient of IUI or what are you talking? You're talking of an IVF patient?
IUI
patient. Fine. If an IUI patient comes and say if the endometrium is not adequate enough, so of course I'll start with the estrogen in the beginning.
Okay.
But suppose it's a persistent thin endometrium patient who's been having in every cycle, then definitely I'll go for a hysteroscopy first. I'll try to evaluate the reason why the endometrium is thin. Maybe I'll take a biopsy. And then try to decide about the I'll also do some certain investigations to rule out why the endometrium is thin, and then go ahead.
How many such cycles of estrogen before you decide she needs hysteroscopy?
See, IUI, if one cycle of estrogen of the endometrium is not growing, next cycle I'll do a hysteroscopy and then I'll do IUI.
Fair enough. Dr. Nilesh Balkavde, sir, scissor or cautery? And any tips that you may have to, maximize best the chances of success and reduce damage?
So I'll just answer all the questions just in one go, short time. So okay. I think what you asked is the history of pox, what Venu sir said, it will differ as per the region of our country. So where Dr. Sanket, we together practicing Pune, Mumbai, these areas have a high incidence of pox. We can see around 30% of the patients with thin endometrium having adhesions.
Yes.
And some patients may also have T-shaped uterus. So I think for every case of thin endometrium, whenever we are diagnosing thin endometrium, that is at around the luteal phase of the cycle. So definitely we'll go for hysteroscopy in every case and see and treat immediately. So use of scissors is what is recommended. And if we see the adhesions near the internal os and the lower down are easy to handle. But if we see near the cornu and at the fundus, they are difficult to handle. Then the severity of the adhesions is also there, if they're flimsy or dense adhesions. So if the adhesions are dense enough and we are not able to approach, and if the adhesions at the internal os are also severe, we should take help of assistance with ultrasonography or assistance with laparoscopy instead of creating a false passage. So whenever we are doing, we should do with the office hysteroscope and we should not do dilatation anytime.
That should be practiced.
Yeah. So we should go in with the office hysteroscope, see whether we are able to go inside through a small opening. If we are not able to grow, so instead of doing a false passage, I have an ultrasound in my ovum pickup room. I just shift that ultrasound and under ultrasound guidance, I go inside. Once inside the cavity, I take care of all the adhesions with scissors.
Okay, fine. So, Dr. Vimi Bindra, madam, any more surgical tips that you would like to add that will make the surgery better, or has Dr. Nilesh covered it all?
No, I think he has covered it all. The only thing in my patient's profile, I just wanted to mention, one is tuberculosis post-abortal, and I'm also seeing a lot of international patients who have post-cesarean. So most of the time after cesarean, they're developing secondary infertility. Very interesting. And they are African ladies most of the time.
Okay.
And they have usually grade 3 adhesions.
Okay. We are also using scissors. I think Dr. Nilesh has covered almost all of the points.
Fine.
We also take ultrasound guidance help if required. Fine. And we go slowly so that we don't perforate.
Okay.
And sometimes we do counsel them for the second setting as well, because re-adhesion formation is also there. Yes. So office hysteroscopy can be done as a later date as
fine.
Well.
Fine. Dr. Saini, madam, next question is for you. But if you have anything to add to the surgical procedure, then you can add. Otherwise, I would like to directly ask you, what do you use for post-op adhesion prevention? Estrogen, Foley's, copper T, or you don't use anything you feel they are not required?
Now for anybody, I am putting inside the cavity. I am just using estrogen, high dose estrogen and continuous estrogen, like 4 milligram TDS for 1 month at least. And I again repost the patient in the next cycle for the re-loop hysteroscopy, because adhesion generally 50% dubara ban jate hain. So then we have to go for again the adhesiolysis. And it may take like 3 or 4 sitting at least. So I, in the first sitting, I definitely counsel directly ki it may take 3 or 4 cycles, 4 sittings to completely go the adhesions. And for the 3 months, I put the patient for the estrogen, high dose estrogen.
Okay. So no foreign body and no second look hysteroscopy must.
Because it causes a chronic endometritis, and the AHL guidelines also not recommend any foreign body should be put inside the cavity.
Okay, I'm going to cycle this question around to the others also, but one point that I would like to add before we move on is that we try to excise rather than incise the fibrous tissue. So if you see an adhesion band, rather than cutting it in the midline, if you can cut it from the top and cut it from the bottom and take it out as a chunk, then probably the chances of it remaining behind as a foreign body at either of the ends is a little less. So coming back to Dr. Venugopal, sir, what is your take? Estrogen, Foley's, IUD, or no IUD?
Yeah, what we do is we put Foley's for a week and then remove it after 1 week. And then we have high dose estrogen for 3 months, like you said, and then I repeat re-look hysteroscopy after that.
Okay, but you don't feel Foley's has increased chance of infection or pressure necrosis because of the bulb being there for 7 days?
Not seen as such. We do put it for a week.
Okay. So, Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam, what is your opinion?
See, we normally don't put Foley's. We always put the patient on estrogens, you know, afterwards, a good high-dose estrogens, and then do a re-look surgery. You know, that's what we normally go up.
Okay. Dr. Nilesh?
We have to counsel the patient about the presence of residual endometrium. If you see the adhesions and if you see some part of endometrium, you see how much endometrium is present, the functional endometrium. And that's how you counsel the patient. So if there are dense adhesions and the endometrium is less, we are thinking at a poor prognosis. We have to counsel accordingly. But as Sushila madam has said, it cannot be done immediately in the first setting. So at least 2 or 3 sitting might be necessary before we come to a conclusion that the endometrium is non-functional.
No, but you put Foley's or you don't put Foley's?
No.
You don't put Foley's. Okay, fine. So let us see what the... Before we move on to the review of literature, coming back again to Dr. Venugopal, sir. Sir, in patients whom you deliver after they conceive, patients with this very thin endometrium and poor synecdoche, is there any difference in the obstetric outcome of these patients?
Regarding obstetric, this thing, it's only sometimes related to placentation, abnormal placentation and, problems arising out of it, like early and mid-trimester bleeding and those sort of things. Tell you the truth, we do get outcomes actually in real bad Asherman. You don't have such very good outcomes after that. But then in obstetrics, this is the one we found as problems. Related to placentation, yeah.
Right. I think most of us have that. Dr. Pooja Mehta, madam, any experience with these newer therapies? It is outside the scope of today's hysteroscopy discussion, but in just one line, if you can sum up, if you're using any of these or any of you volunteering to be vouching for one of these therapies, saying that it works really well. Dr. Pooja Mehta?
We are using all these adjuvant therapies. Till date, I think other than stem cells and to some extent PRP, nothing else is actually proven. Okay. And in fact, they are also in we are still doing the studies on it. So they are definitely, but we are using all of these things. You know, depends on the cases. Of course, evidence doesn't support all these things. As adjuvant therapies should not be used for thin endometrium. Definitely stem cell and PRP are good in recurrent implantation failures along with thin endometrium. But per se, thin endometrium, the endometrial thickness will not increase with all these things, you know.
Okay.
So definitely, ESHRAE guidelines also came up on these things, but it doesn't support all this. But so we are using it for sure.
The PRP, you are injecting subendometrially or you are just putting it in the uterine cavity like the IUI?
PRP we are putting as the IUI, but stem cells we are injecting subendometrially.
Okay. Anybody in the panel having any specific experience on these treatments can volunteer to speak? I can't see your hand, so you'll have to speak directly.
We have started using PRP, but we are using it subendometrially.
Okay.
Not as IUI.
Okay. Okay. Fine. So I think then we can move on to the next. Just a review of literature. Literature suggests to minimize unipolar and bipolar instrumentation, so use scissor. They are all advocating the use of estrogens for 10 days. But then again, it is worthwhile to remember that a lot of studies and a lot of schools of thought are now coming up questioning the need for giving estrogen in a patient who is having a normal ovarian function. So they are asking that if the ovaries are functioning normally and the patient already has estrogen in her bloodstream, what is the point of giving the excess estrogen? This is another debatable point and a school of thought which is coming in slowly. But as of now, most of us are giving postoperative estrogens, but this is also something that is being questioned. A hyalobarriers gel is something that is not available in India. It's available outside India and is shown to have a good beneficial effect after myomectomy. And if you look at studies, no physical barriers have been shown to reduce adhesion significantly. But again, if you ask me personally, I'm putting it in the Foley's catheter in practically all of my operated patients. As far as reproductive outcome is concerned, the pool rate of pregnancy is 50%. But like Dr. Venugopal sir said, early pregnancy loss is there, mid-trimester loss is there, and a lot of patients having placental accreta syndrome because of placentation issues and deep burrowing of the placenta because of the absence of the basalis layer. But the one thing that we need to share with our patients is that pregnancy rate in women with severe adhesions is significantly lower than in patients with mild adhesions. So this is something that has to be remembered regardless of whether patient is going for ART or not. Now, I think this is the last slide that we have. And if I would like just to take just your opinion one by one, if you have seen these cases and how you manage them. Can we start with Dr. Sushila Saini? Madam, any experience in managing micropolyposis and chronic endometritis? And if you see this picture, what do you do?
Yeah, we have gone through these kind of the pictures because we are doing routinely the hysteroscopies and we put the patient on the actually antibiotics. But excellent. We take actually first the biopsy from the endometrium.
Okay.
And we will send it for the histopathology and we will send it for culture also.
Okay.
So we can see if the bacterial growth or any other growth is there. And tuberculosis testing is also sent for the biopsy.
Okay. Okay.
And according to the investigation result, we will treat and the simple doxycycline we will put when the result is coming, waiting for the result.
Okay. So most of the times you are treating these patients with doxycycline.
Yeah.
Dr. Venugopal, sir, any difference of opinion?
No, doxycycline, yeah. We are doxycycline. We don't think so much in terms of tuberculosis. We think in terms of the endometritis angle, give doxycycline. It works.
But our side, tuberculosis is common, actually.
I agree with you. Like, I've been in Pune and I think that's it. Too many micropolypi sometimes, too many small polyps, multiple polyps, if they are not conventionally, you are not able to get rid of them. Sometimes the dose of GnRH agonist to decrease the estrogen helps.
Even in micropolyps, sometimes we give, after the endometrial evaluation, sometimes giving progesterone therapy.
Yeah, something to decrease.
Also helps in reducing the, endometrial thickness after.
Is it? Okay, fine. Dr. Nilesh Valkavade, this last picture, the adenomyotic crypt, is it something that you encounter frequently? And how do you treat it if you see it?
So we encounter it in cases of adenomyosis, definitely yes. We can give a nick over it, but I don't know how much it will help because it's a generalized disease. Usually adenomyosis presents as a diffuse adenomyosis than rather odd cases of focal adenomyosis. So we have to treat it as a complete disease of the uterus. Maybe if we are planning a transfer up for this patient immediately after doing a hysteroscopy, we may put the patient on a GnRH agonist like leuprolide acetate or decapeptyl before considering a transfer in such cases of adenomyosis to prevent implantation failure.
Okay. So do you cut this script or do you burn it or any idea which one is better?
Just cut it. There is just a pocket form. Yes. These are usually hemorrhagic pockets because of the adenomyosis. We just cut it so that the pocket is released. I don't know whether it helps or not because the disease is not being cured here.
Correct.
But it's
correct.
Just a personal satisfaction that you are doing something.
Absolutely. Dr. Vimi Bindra, any experience with these kind of scripts and what you do with them?
Same. We just cut it and drain the fluid inside.
Perfect, perfect. I think that is what most of us are doing. Some of us are cutting it with the scissors. Some of us are fulgurating it so that probably the disease below also gets managed. I think this is the last slide of this presentation, but we are going to take a lot of audience questions. So please hang on. And before we move on, I think we will take the question from Dr. Sandesh Kade sir first. I don't know if he's still there, but sir, if you're still there, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question to the panelists? Is sir still there with us?
He's there.
Dr. Sanket?
Yes, sir.
No, Dr. Sandesh.
Sandesh Kade. Anyway, we will...
Do you want me to unmute him?
Yes.
Anyway,
yes.
You can.
Yeah. Dr. Sandesh, you are unmuted. You can speak.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
We can hear you.
Yeah, congratulations. Excellent panel, excellent moderation. And thank you, Isar, for such a wonderful panel. And my question was, while we were discussing that metroplasty, whether you will do metroplasty in small uterus or more importantly, unicornuate uterus. Because we see a lot of people doing metroplasty for a unicornuate uterus. Does it really help?
Excellent question. Let's start one by one and let's see what people have to say. Let's start with Sushila Saini, madam. What is your, which side you would be?
Unicornuate uterus is like a banana shaped cavity. And there is a cornu on one side and there is no cornu on the other side. If there is no cornu, there's a cavity volume is very less. Then we have to go just a little bit lateral metroplasty, but it should be very much cautiously because it may lead to the perforation. So if you have the first 3D sonography and then you know actually the thickness of the wall, so then you can exactly measure how much deep you has to go inside. So 3D sonography helps a lot in doing this kind of the metroplasty to increase the uterine volume. So it may increase our obstetric outcomes.
Okay. Dr. Vimi Bindra, madam, what is your thing?
I think I agree with Dr. Sushila. So we have to be careful when we do the lateral metroplasty in unicornuate uterus and to avoid perforation and all. But definitely sometimes I need expansion of the cavity. Not all cases, selective cases.
Dr. Nilesh, what about you? Would you like to operate this patient or not required?
Yes, we are doing for a cavity expansion surgery. So either the side opposite to the cornu, where you form the unicornuate uterus, that side a little bit more cavity enhancement can be done. And also another thing which was there when I was practicing with Nalkani Hospital, they used to do a star-shaped metroplasty, what Dr. Nagendra Sardesh Pandey is doing there. So that is another option for unicornuate uterus.
Okay.
And Dr. after that, we put the patient on high-dose estrogen. That should be followed.
Fine. Dr. Sandesh Kade, sir, you are extremely up to date on most points of discussion and most areas of endoscopy. Sir, please give us your valuable opinion on this.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Clear.
Yes, sir.
No, I agree to almost all the points discussed here. And it is really interesting. The point which we want to bring out is in unicornuate, very often they have found that the other side uterine artery is absent. You have uterine artery only on one side.
Okay.
Okay. The other part, which is the other part of the uterus, which is not developed or is very small, rudimentary and lateral, the uterine artery would be away. So this is always a gray zone, whether to incise in a unicornuate, but cavity expansion can be tried depending upon a 3D ultrasound and actually identifying the thickness of the myometrium. Otherwise, better avoid it.
Perfect. Yeah, perfect.
Definitely.
So now, thank you, sir. Thank you, Sandesh Kade, sir. You always add value to discussions.
What about small uterus?
Yeah,
small
even in hypoplastic uterus, there is a study in BJOG, 29 cases done, tubular uterus, the cylindrical tubular uterus. Hmm. Even there, if you can do some kind of cavity expansion, it has been shown to improve the outcomes and decrease the... that's probably the only option you can offer the patient. In the classic, when we are discussing the T shape, we said there's a version which looks like an eye, you know, eye. Mm-hmm. So it's so much tubular. Then in those cases also, if you can use your scissors, of course, a 3D examination, a 3D ultrasound is very important because you know that, want to know the shoulders which you can release, the thickness of the wrist, yeah.
Absolutely. So now I think I will shift the moderation to Dr. Vimi Bindra, madam. Madam, could you please take the questions and direct them to the panelists and as you feel appropriate.
Okay. I'll ask one by one. Dr. Deepa Kapoor has asked, what is the conservative treatment for polyp? I think Dr. Nilesh can answer this.
I think there is no conservative treatment for polyp. If you are going for infertility and if we diagnose a polyp, we get it out.
Actually, initially we were discussing there was a polyp 7 millimeter. We will wait for some time. So I think in this respect, they have questioned this conservative treatment.
Medical line of management, according to me, even I think OC pills won't help much. We just follow the patient up for maybe 2 or 3 months and assess the patient if it is an incidental diagnosis. If it is a polyp which is more than 1 centimeter, we treat it immediately.
No, there are people who have, you know, that was a lady who didn't have children, but then there are people who put an LNG, IUS and different sort of things. You sort of cut down the estrogen. So that's the principle behind it. Probably that's it. But in that lady, what we went was to just wait and repeat a scan after 3 months.
Yes.
We didn't, yeah.
Another question from Dr. Shashi Raghuvanshi. Will you do polypectomy at the time of pickup? Dr. Pooja Mehta, can you answer this, please?
We already said that actually. Definitely, I will not do it if you ask me. And anyways, because polyp is not usually a single polyp. Sometimes there can be multiple polyps associated. So I would wait for the stimulation to get over. I'll freeze the embryos. I'll then do a polypectomy. I'll do a hysteroscopic polypectomy. I'll do the evaluation of the endometrium. I'll send the polyp for a histopathology examination, and then I will go ahead for a FET cycle immediately post hysteroscopy. You know, that's what I would do.
I think this question Dr. Sanket can answer. So somebody has asked, when we do 2 sitting myomectomies, hysteroscopic myomectomy, there is a risk of bleeding if we leave the myoma inside. What are the risks involved here?
Oh, no.
The panelist delegate has asked.
No, there is no risk of this thing involved. In fact, for any fibroid that is 3 centimeters or larger in size, in your primary counseling, you must tell the patient that it may end up in a 2-stage procedure because there is a fundamental difference between lap myomectomy and hysteroscopic myomectomy. The difference is that in lap myomectomy, you are going to take the fibroid out as a whole, and therefore you measure the fibroid in terms of its diameter, 2 centimeters, 3 centimeters, 4 centimeters. But when you come to hysteroscopic myomectomy, you are going to shell out the volume of the fibroid. And because volume is calculated by the formula of pi r cube, the volume that has to be removed is much more than the diameter of the fibroid, which has to be pulled out as a whole. So 3 centimeters or anything exceeding, you can safely do a 2-stage surgery if you feel that you are causing fluid overload. Again, the best way to find this out is to do fluid balance estimation in between the surgery once few bottles of saline are over and not stop till the end of the surgery when you find out that you've already pushed her into overload and now is the time to stop. So it can safely be done. The remaining fibroid does not cause any bleeding.
Thank you, Dr. Sanket. So, Dr. Venugopal, can you please answer this question? Somebody has asked, when we do hysteroscopic resection, how can we avoid damage to the endometrium?
When you do hysteroscopic resection, how can we avoid?
Which resection?
Yeah.
Septal resection.
Maybe the question is about myoma or septum.
Fibroids, mucosal fibroids.
Myoma, I think. Maybe myoma, they did not mention actually. Will not hysteroscopic resection damage the endometrium? I think Dr. Sanket discussed this. He was saying he would prefer to do laparoscopically to avoid the damage to the endometrium.
If the surface area is large, I think that's what Sanket said, that to avoid extensive damage. But otherwise, the endometrium is something which is capable of regenerating. I don't know why we should be too much worked up about that. Because the endometrium regenerates, doesn't it? So after you yeah.
Yeah. So if it is a sessile polyp and the base is a little bit more, in that case, you may damage the endometrium. So care should be taken that you enter the pseudo capsule and just enucleate the polyp sometimes. And if you have a hysteroscopic morcellator, well and good. Otherwise, you can remove as much as possible and then go for a two-step procedure as we all discussed.
Dr. Sushila can answer this. Somebody has asked. One is endpoint of resection, very common question and very good question as well. And do all panelists do hysteroscopy with or without anesthesia?
I am doing my all hysteroscopies with anesthesia if it is not office hysteroscopy or for a diagnostic purpose only. And definitely I will do myomar resection in under anesthesia with all control. And the end point of the myoma resection is when we see the pink muscle tissue, muscle fibers at the base. And that is actually the end point. And all the fibroid tissues coming out and all the, we are just working inside the capsule only. So there is a less chances of perforating the myometrium. And with the bipolar resectoscope, not using the monocular resectoscope.
Somebody has asked, anybody has experience of myoma screw in hysteroscopy? Is it cumbersome? If anybody has used, please answer.
Dr. Sanket will made it.
I have not used personally, but there is a 3 millimeter myoma screw which is available. I think Nitin, I don't know if Nitin is listening to this discussion, Dr. Nitin Shah has papers published on this. And he has, in his this thing, he has said that he has put a myoma spiral, small myoma spiral. Of course, it doesn't go through the operative channel, but it goes by the side of the channel. And then using that myoma screw, you are able to give a traction on the fibroid. What this helps in is that you get a second hand in the uterus, which you will normally never get. So with one hand giving traction on the fibroid and the other hand cutting at the base, you are able to detach the fibroid in some cases. But now the problem is, after the fibroid is out, how will you get it outside the uterus? So be careful in which cases you are using this. If you think that the net size of the fibroid is not going to be deliverable outside the uterus, then you might as well resect it. But this idea of holding with a myoma screw or sometimes with even a small tenaculum is there. And yes, people are doing it.
So in this, I would like to comment, actually, I have not tried this technique, but I met Dr. Sergio a couple of months back in this March. So I was discussing with him, he is doing office hysteroscopy with the laser and even for 5, 6, 7 centimeter fibroid, the complete submucous one, the grade zero ones. So I asked him, how do you remove it in the office? He said, I don't remove it. He just cut it and leaves it inside. And after 3 months, the scan there. And the fibroid disappears. I have never practiced it and no first-hand experience.
I have done a pilot study on it.
Okay.
I have done a pilot study of it on it and it's very encouraging. So I am going with the scissors only, not with the resectoscope. But as it is not published, I didn't mention it on record here.
Yeah.
But with the scissors, if we enter the cavity of the fibroid and if we dissect it, like what we are doing in laparoscopic myomectomy, and we can leave such fibroids inside the cavity. They don't cause any pain or post-operative vaginal bleeding. And if we do a repeat ultrasound after 2 months, they usually vanish. And if it is a large size fibroid, we may have to do a second look hysteroscopy and just remove it whenever it is small in size.
So vanish means disappear or
they disappear.
It disappears and some of the cases it degenerates and sloughs off.
Yes.
And they have done a study of almost 200 to 250 patients and published it as well.
I have done a study of around 15 cases, very positive and promising results from that.
Okay. Okay.
So I was, because I have got a laser machine, but because of the lockdown, I could never use it. So I was planning to use it in the office and then leave it and then see.
Okay.
And somebody has asked any experience of using vasopressin for a submucous hysteroscopic myomectomy?
Yeah. Definitely, we have the experience. We are using the vasopressin at the cervix, or we can actually inject in the base of the myoma also with the operative channel, and it very much helpful in dissecting the myoma. How? Because it constricts the vessels and it actually decreases the fluid absorption in the system actually. So it actually gives a window to operate more, and we can complete in the one setting all the myoma section without any fluid overload. Definitely, we have to use.
And one more question from Dr. Jasmine. What fluid management system is being used, gravity or pump method?
We are using hysteroscopic pump.
not gravity or any, this is like, we have to use the complete input-output measuring system and the electronic system.
Dr. Sushila, can you just answer, please? How do you inject vasopressin, Dr. Shashi is asking.
Yeah, we can inject as the both the side. We can inject in the cervical tissue, like this is like 3 o'clock or 6 o'clock position, or we can inject it with the needle at the base of the myoma, like you are injecting the PRP in the subendometrially. We can inject it subendometrial level below the fibroid with the same needle.
Amit.
Yes, sir.
Dr.
Amit, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
In the audience, there is Dr. Jasmine is there. I think she is continuously writing something on the chat. Can you unmute her and ask her to say, tell her that if she wants to address something here in this?
Of course. Dr. Jasmine, ma'am, we have unmuted you.
Hi. Dr. Jasmine, welcome. Hi.
Thank you. Actually, I'm so sorry. The name is, I'm Dr. Alka Kumar. There is a name.
Oh my God.
I'm so sorry about this.
Madam, you should have identified yourself first.
No. This was a family chat we were having.
My God.
So it's just that. So anyway, it's a great show and I have really enjoyed everything. And my suggestions are, that it would be great if we talk more about, you know, distension, about visualization, about fluid management, about office hysteroscopy, because I think that's where we need to kind of focus so that we have more generating material. And also I saw your address on adenomyosis and chronic endometritis. My congratulations for that, because really we have four very specific, hysteroscopic markers for chronic endometritis. One being that you will see the gland will be surrounded by a red halo.
Mm-hmm.
There will be micropolyps less than 1 millimeter in size, and there will be undulating endometrium along with stromal edema. So these are the four factors, and hysteroscopically they are very visible. So if you will club your finding hysteroscopically with the diagnosis of a histopath examination with plasma cells, that makes the diagnosis very clear. And we have this published data in the JMIG. Mm. And then depending on that, you will choose your antibiotics on the reports which are going to be there. Okay. Regarding tuberculosis, since we have done a lot of work on tuberculosis as well, there are a set of hysteroscopic markers in tuberculosis which are actually very evident. So all of you guys are doing great hysteroscopies, as I see in the pictures. So you will get to see the endometrium, which is actually very bizarre. It's just got no character to itself. The proliferative phase of endometrium is very, it's a very smooth looking endometrium, while endometrial tuberculosis will be a bizarre endometrium. There will be deposits which are there. And sometimes you can get to see even tubercles. In fact, one of my publications, which was on the cover page of JMIG a few months back, was a tubercular abscess, which we saw inside the uterine cavity. So that is the other thing. And of course, Syneke, which we have been talking about. And I personally think that in our country, a lot of Syneke are because of endometrial tuberculosis.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jasmine. Dr. Alka Kumar.
So we had this friends meet actually, and this we had this, you know, Zoom, so we were changing our names and it was fun. So I'm sorry about that.
Thank you so much, madam, for your valuable inputs. It is always a pleasure.
Dr. Vijay Nahata is also on the chat. And sir is giving input.
Sir, any
also.
Comments?
We can unmute him also just for expert opinion, yes, because Dr. Vijay Nahata is very good in hysteroscopy and a leading surgeon in
absolutely.
The country.
Dr. Vijay Nahata, sir, you have been unmuted. Also, your video can be started.
Yeah, definitely. Good.
Yeah. Thank you for...
sir, in the proper house mood.
it's a very fantastic and very practical questions are being put. And regarding that myoma screw, I have used only in 2 cases, but those are very, very small ones, like 1.5. Mm-hmm. Because it's a very delicate instrument And so it should not be used in bigger ones. And then you have to take the help of the jet going below that myoma, and then you can scoop it out. And what doctor was telling, that leaving myoma inside, I have got a very good practical experience. It really is very nice. You can always leave that without much of a problem. That is those myomas. So it's not always necessary. And what Dr. Nilesh, he was telling about that scooping and enucleating the myoma. Yes, for submucous myomas, it's a good one. We should try those ones, because we are not damaging the endometrium at all. We are not using electrical energy.
Dr. Meenakshi also has the same experience leaving the myoma inside, and she has also a lot of the cases leaving myoma inside after resection. And she says actually that it will come out after decreasing the size as old. So Meenakshi Goyal from Hisar is also supporting this, leaving the myoma inside the cavity, and it will come out as own when its size is decreased.
Can I give one question to all the panelists?
Of course.
See, if you are doing a myomectomy and the bleeding doesn't stop, somebody asked about uterine packing. So it's a very practical question. You are doing resection, fluid overload is going to happen. You stop the surgery, but bleeding doesn't stop. Now, what do you do? Step one, step two, step three.
We can try it with the first identifying the bleeder, and we can cauterize it. And if it is not stopped by the cauterizing it, then we can put a Foley's catheter inside and inflate the bulb up to 10 ml, so it can give the pressure over the bleeder, and it can be left for the 24 to 48 hours. And if actually bleeding is there, so then it come it out with the Foley's catheter out, and we can actually monitor if it's bleeding stopped or not stopped.
Very good answer, I think.
So, and sir, I would also do if there is really, actually there is very less possibility that there is such torrential bleeding. Such torrential bleeding usually only happens when you have cut a pedicle that you should have cauterized in the first place. This is probably the only instance that I have found such torrential bleeding to occur. So there was a fibroid polyp and you should have cauterized it from its base, but you cut it because you were plain lazy, and then the bleeding has started. So this is generally the only instance where troublesome bleeding happens. In this case, the cavity will suddenly become entirely red and you don't know what to do. So the best thing is open the outflow completely, increase the inflow pressure. The sputter will start becoming seen. As you gradually lower the inflow pressure, the bleeding will seem. Go with the resectoscope and specifically cauterize that particular area. In another instance, if there is a lot of bleeding and it is from everywhere, then massage the uterus, give tranexamic acid, leave Foley's catheter inside and wait. Most of the times, I have never had a patient where it has not stopped.
I specifically categorize this thing when we are doing the sessile polyp or fibroid polyp, we are using the cautery and not using it with the scissor. That is the point why we are using the energy in cutting this kind of the polyps.
Yes.
So it is supporting the same thing.
My next question to the all panelists is, if a pregnancy can get implanted into the fallopian tube which has endosalpings less than 0.5 millimeter, right? So what is the issue with 6.5 millimeter endometrium? Why doesn't get implanted?
Refer to IVF.
Yeah, I'll refer to IVF.
No. See, the important point is here, all of you are saying about 3D ultrasound, okay? My little experience is looking at the vascularity of the endometrium is something very important.
Yes.
The vascularity, most of the time the vascularity in this endometrium is very good. The primary vessel does not bifurcate, and the blood which is reaching the interzones is at a very high oxygen pressure. That's the reason the implantation doesn't happen. So I think looking at the cause, and if the volume is only less, then doing lateral metroplasty would help. As far as the PRP and stem cells are concerned, I really have no idea about whether how does it help. But especially there are people are claiming that injecting subendometrially at the time of hysteroscopy, I wonder how the cells are going to migrate to the other parts of the endometrium and how endometrium is going to grow is something, a point to be debatable. Because the problem is we use a mixture of four things. We will use estrogen also, we use Aliver also, Viagra also, we'll inject also. So I think we need to have a proper study regarding this injection of stem cells or PRP inside the cavity, I mean subendometrium.
Yes, sir.
I'm done.
Yeah, yeah. Very good
suggestions. And it's a point worth introspecting because we just start adopting things which are not standards of practice without giving it much thought. And then the moment we publish a series of, say, 5 or 10 cases, suddenly everybody tries to do it. So I think what Dr. Kedar said, there's a point that we need to introspect the way we do our IVF. Because if you see in established programs, they never go beyond standards of practice. So when we talk in meetings like this, and that, those type of messages are very important to get across. I think we should agree with that.
Sandesh Kade has written some opinion right now.
He is saying it is causing more fibrosis.
Okay. Okay.
Because there are totipotent cells.
Hmm. Any other questions?
I think we are done. One more question is there where we were discussing adhesion excision or adhesion division. So somebody has asked that excision will cause more damage to the endometrium and the myometrium versus incision of the adhesions. So how do we deal with it?
No, not at all. In fact, if there is an adhesion band and if it is possible for you to cut the adhesion band and remove it in its entirety, that will leave a lot less fibrous tissue and a lot less foreign body behind and will encourage the endometrium to grow over the part where you have denuded the endometrium or reached up till the level of the blood vessels so that the estrogen can actually reach there and the endometrium can grow over that cut part. When you are only dividing a band, you are leaving two ends of fibrous tissue on each side and there is no way that the endometrium is going to epithelialize that area. And so if implantation occurs there, then again the pregnancy will fail. So no risk at all and a lot of benefit. Only problem is the difficulty in doing it because the scissors works parallel to your optic. It does not come in at a right angle like laparoscopy. So you have to really take care to remove it. It's almost like sculpting out a piece of stone from a rock.
Yes. So excising it increases the vascularity as well. And that gives a chance for the endometrium to regrow.
Yes.
So always excision of the adhesion bands is better than the incision.
If possible.
My question is to Nilesh. Nilesh, as Jasmine, Dr. Alka Kumar was telling, why don't we have one or two quick questions on the visualization if it's hampered? And anybody else can take a question of how to look at the fluid management if this question has not been taken.
These two
questions.
Yeah, if during surgery, if you have a jet of blood flowing or then it's not cauterized and the visualization is hampered, we just increase the pressure for some time. Yeah. And we stop doing, if you are put in a seizure through operative channel, we just remove that so that the pressure is maintained and we wait for some time. Generally, if it is a small spurter, it will handle the bleeding and the visualization becomes nice. If there is a lot of blood in the cavity, we may have to do aspiration, suction with the outflow tract.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect.
And what Dr. Sanket said that we may have to go in, see the bleeder and coagulate it, pinpoint for that. And regarding your second question, my points on that, to decrease the fluid overload. So that's most common in resection, hysteroscopic resection, which we are doing in fertility only for myoma. So hysteroscopic myoma resection should usually be done under using a bipolar resectoscope rather than a monopolar, so that we have a normal saline in place rather than glycine, one thing. Second thing, just before the procedure, we instill 0.1 units of vasopressin per ml and maximum 8 ml of this solution should be used in the paracervical region. So this will definitely decrease the blood flow to the myoma and also prevent the fluid absorption.
Nilesh, it is a bilateral injection or unilateral?
We are giving it at 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock.
Okay, so bilateral.
Yeah.
Two cases.
Okay. Yes. And preoperative use of the GnRH decreases the blood flow because it decreases the actually estrogen level in the uterus and it decreases the absolute absorption. So preoperatively, GnRH is very much helpful in for the myomer resection by the hysteroscopy.
Perfect. Would you, when you are posting a patient for a hysteroscopic like this surgery, you expect a fluid overload to happen? Would you do a serum electrolytes before the surgery? And do you do that?
No, not before the surgery.
Not before the
surgery. If we are expecting a complicated surgery, like a large myoma or odd location of a myoma according to the Lassmer classification, so in those cases, we may do a serum electrolytes. That will definitely help us.
What I mean to say is...
Normally, all the pre-op investigations... Sorry. Normally, all the pre-anesthesia investigations would include a serum electrolytes and all, normally for all major surgeries, you know, where we are expecting some fluid overload. And along with that, even coagulograms and all will be done, you know, in this patient.
Yeah, definitely, the routine investigation may include, like when we are ordering the kidney function test or renal function test, this will automatically include the serum, but not specifically asking.
Next question is, as anybody... manage the case of fluid overload. Sanket, I think you have seen it.
Many I also seen.
Please guide us. How do you correct it? You know, what I know is it's not only that, it's the sodium which goes for a toss, right? So how do you correct it? Do you admit the patient? You take a physician's help? And what do you do?
So first of all, sir, to answer your earlier question first of all, you have to expect that fluid overload is going to happen. In expecting fluid overload, there are specific categories of patients which go into fluid overload. Number one is size of fibroid. Fibroid larger than 3 centimeters has a more chance of fluid overload. Number two is not just size of the fibroid, but the grade of the fibroid. So purely intracavitary fibroid type 0, less chance. But as the fibroid burrows more and more into the myometrium, there is more chance that you will push in more fluid as you are extracting the fibroid. So these patients will go into overload. Thirdly, anemic patients. These anemic patients have got less oxygen carrying capacity anyway. When you dilute their blood with even more saline, the oxygen carrying capacity reduces further. So in a non-anemic patient, she will go into overload later. But an anemic patient will quickly go into overload. So anemia with large fibroid is a very bad combination to operate. You would rather treat her first. The fourth category of patient is a patient who has got any kind of COPD, bronchial asthma or anything else in which the lungs are already congested and you overload this patient and she will go into failure quickly. So expect overload in these patients. I would do serum electrolytes first for the simple reason that if you haven't done them first, you don't know how much they have changed later. So if you don't have a prior value, you cannot compare it with the later value and take a decision. Third, your question on how to manage. Most of the times, they are simply managed by propped up position, nasal O2 and Lasix. 20 milligram, 40 milligram, repeat 20, repeat 20, it doesn't matter. It won't kill the patient repeating Lasix, but it will get her out fast. What is not to be done is to not give her IV sodium. Because you are not qualified to give her IV sodium, you will cause by means of hypernatremia, central pontine myelinosis, and patient will land up in big trouble. So unless you are in an ICU setting with a physician who knows what he is doing, do not correct the sodium loss. Just wait for it to go.
Excellent.
Anybody has more inputs? Yeah.
But one thing, Morgi, cardiac patient also need more chances of... overload. We have to go for echo on every patient before hysteroscopy, operative hysteroscopy, like this kind of the major surgery. Order echo.
24-year-old girl also, you'll ask for 2D echocardiography.
So we are going for hysteroscopic myomectomy, then definitely. Yes.
Sandesh Kade wants to come in. Please put him inside and tell him not to leave the group now.
Yes, please, sir. We'll do that.
I'll start the video also.
And I personally feel that, you know, your anesthetist has to be very strong.
Yes.
You know, when my wife is an anesthetist, when I tell her to give 40 milligrams of Lasix, single bolus, she looks at me as if I told her.
Hello.
No, okay, no. Sanjay, go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent discussion. Very practical and very important.
We can start the video also for sir.
No, we want to see you, Sandesh. You are in India now.
I have opened the option, but he is saying he will start later.
Very important point I want to add is what happens is there are two things that can go wrong. One is fluid overload, which every one of us can manage. But rightly told by Sanket, it is the electrolyte imbalance which is very, very dangerous and the effects are irreversible. So, if she has brain edema and damage, pontine damage, then it is irreversible. So, we have to avoid that. And the best way is to use GnRH. Whenever you have very big fibroids and you are going for hysteroscopic myomectomy, please, please, please use GnRH because it not only reduces the size. 1 centimeter reduction is a huge reduction in volume. Secondly, when you give GnRH, it will suppress estrogen. And this estrogen is the cause for many deaths that happen in hysteroscopy. And these are young girls. Because hysteroscopic death don't happen in postmenopausal women or small girls. It happens in reproductive age and that is the culprit is estrogen. So if you block this estrogen, the pump which is responsible for this sodium exchange remains active. And even if she has hyponatremia, she will correct by herself. So GnRH is not only to reduce the size of the fibroid, but to make the surgery safer, especially when you anticipate, when you do preoperative recording and Lasmar scoring. If it's a difficult one, wait for some time, give GnRH and then take her. We might save a life. Yeah.
Yes. Now, definitely. Now, don't leave. My next question, I don't think so. You must have taken this. While doing a hysteroscopy, how do you know that you have done a perforation? If you have done a perforation, how do you manage this perforation? Sorry, I have become a moderator now.
No, definitely. It is becoming interesting now and it is now the practical question and it is question for the operating surgeons now. Yes. We are happy. Definitely.
Volume goes down. Intrauterine volume goes down and suddenly you don't see some. So that is when you should immediately suspect and stop your electro surgery.
Mm-hmm. And then what to do?
Then you have to really confirm. And laparoscopy, you can go in with a small laparoscope, 5 mm scope to confirm it. And if you have used electro surgery, then immediately don't move, make her head low or anything. See if you are having any bowel loops very close to that perforated area. See, inspect the bowel areas. And if you don't have any problem, if it's a very small incision, it can be left alone. If it is bleeding, you have to put a stitch.
Okay. And do you keep the patient NBM for 24 hours just in case, Sandesh?
If you feel you have done an injury to the bowel, then yes, you can. You have to keep her nil by mouth. You have to keep her under observation. If it's okay. A wide area of cauterization, you can even keep a drain.
Okay. Achha, the other thing is, now you all are talking about this unipolar and bipolar seizures and regular seizures. So, if anybody wants to start up with their own hysteroscopic setup, what kind of cautery machine would you advise? Everybody can answer this. I want to know, should I buy bipolar, should I buy unipolar, should I buy scissor, should I buy laser, what should
be? The cautery we should buy in the starting and if you are doing for the hysteroscopy, it should be taken like monopolar, bipolar, but with the underwater cutting also. Because simple bipolar is not working with the bipolar hysteroscope actually.
Okay.
So underwater cutting cautery we has to buy for working the bipolar resectoscope because it is working in the under the saline. So it is a necessary must thing to buy, first thing.
Mm. I think most of the surgeries we are now doing with cold seizures. So if the cost is an issue, only hysteroscopic myoma resections are the surgeries which will require a cautery at actual. Other cases, most of the times will be managed on, can be managed on cold seizures. So if you are a surgeon who is starting hysteroscopy and doesn't want to venture into myoma resections, normal cautery will do. Sometimes with the use of glycine only for coagulating the bleeders, Otherwise, if you are a surgeon who are routinely doing myoma resections, I think an underwater cautery, as madam said, is definitely useful. For an Indian cautery, it will cost around 6 to 7 lakhs. And
It is become
good, cheaper. Good underwater cautery, madam.
Indian actually make all the jugaad and it becoming like 2 lakhs only. Or simple, agar if you want to purchase only this underwater cautery, this is PB India giving 80,000 or 90,000 only.
That's wonderful information.
Yeah, you do not to spend so much. Like in the 1 lakh, you will call got this normal cautery like monopolar or bipolar, and in 80,000 or 90,000, you will got this underwater cautery. So 2 lakhs will work. And 2 lakh will for the 4 mm hysteroscope. So in 5 lakhs, you will got all the things for starting for properly the hysteroscopic surgery, because it is not like the beginner or it is not like the experienced one. Because agar wo shuru mein use nahi kar raha, then it will take the learning curve higher up. Because वो एक साल बाद फिर 2 साल बाद फिर कॉटरी यूज करना शुरू करेगा, तो दैट इज एक्चुअली स्टॉप द ग्रोथ ऑफ द पर्सन. इट शुड बी इंस्ट्रूमेंट शुड बी परचेज फर्स्ट हैंड, देन इट शुड बी स्टार्टेड प्रॉपरली विद ऑल द इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स एंड लोडेड विद ऑल द इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स एंड प्रॉपर इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स.
आई एग्री.
या
हेलो सर, इज गॉन?
हेलो.
नो
Yeah, can I just add one thing here?
Yes, sir, please.
See, I always have this question, and that is about this PRP and stem cell, you know. So, everybody says PRP and stem cells are totipotent cells. Means if you put it in hair, the cosmetologists are using, so you expect the hair to grow. You are putting it in ovary, they are saying follicle should grow. Now you are putting it in endometrium, and expecting endometrium should grow. So actually, it will get transformed into a cell which is nearest to it. So in adhesions, if we are going to put it in subendometrium, and in we are going to put it in the adhesions, are we not going to make it into more adhesions?
Point me, my boss.
So all these studies are fake. Actually, for the hysteroscopic one, PRP in ovaries is, yes, it is proved and they are showing some results, but when you are putting it in endometrium or fibrotic area, it should produce more fibrosis.
I have no idea, and I'm not using actually the PRP. So if anybody is using the PRP, then he can comment what is the result, what kind of the result they are getting. Because I don't believe in all the things. I just believing in the redoing the hysteroscopy and seeing actually the what. Because redoing hysteroscopies and you are cutting the adhesions and removing all the adhesion bands, it will definitely give the good better results. And even grade four adhesions like Sherman syndromes.
No, PRP everywhere is doubtful. I think Sandesh sir is his queries are correct, because even we are using it for endometrium, ovary, and all that. But they are not standards of practice. The occasional person stands up and says that I got results. Other than that, I think, I don't know. Sandesh sir, I agree with you.
See, this is done only where you don't allow them egg donation and embryo donations. In those countries, it is okay. Whatever can be done empirically is being done for that lady. But otherwise, I don't think.
No. Yeah, that's true.
See, the problem is, you know, we are not doing randomized controlled trial. So after doing 50 patients, your 2 patients conceived. It's otherwise also they would have conceived. How can you say?
Yes.
You should have a randomized controlled trial and then try to put it correctly for your own understanding. And before doing that, you know, if there are totipotent cells, you putting it subendometrially, but during the next menstrual cycle, is it not all that endometrium going to be washed out? Or do you think those cells will go and block the near their radial artery and start producing endometrium from there?
Those cells seem to block our negative thoughts, nothing else. So we become more optimistic that we are doing great things.
Okay. Any other questions? Dr. Nahata is raising his hand. Can you unmute him, please?
Done, sir.
Dr. Nahata, welcome.
Stem cell, still we are working on that, but still what Sandeep sir has recently put is a very thing to be noted that what should be done. And my another question is, one is he told GNRH, and another question about ulipristal, use of ulipristal for reducing the size. What is the opinion of the house? Using ulipristal for reducing the size before attempting a myoma resection.
Actually, in the hysteroscopic myomectomy or hysteroscopic resection of myoma, GNR is much better option than the ulipristal. Because of the estrogen and because we are using only for the decreasing the size only the purpose. And the ulipristal will actually myolyze all the myoma and it will actually difficult to remove the myoma. So I will prefer definitely the GNRH over the ulipristal for the hysteroscopic resections.
Yeah, and what Dr. Sandesh said was very important, decreasing the E2, the estrogen levels. I think
yes, definitely it is protective.
Yeah, I think that's a take-home message for everybody. That.
And recently, actually, there is hepatotoxicity again reported with the ulipristal, and ulipristal is actually taken out from all the market.
Another is the... Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How much people are using the adhesion like Sepra films and hyaluronidase for recurrence of synecdoche? Recurrence of synecdoche is a very big problem. We are facing a lot of recurrence while doing this synecdoche.
Nobody has actually.
Hello?
We are using high dose estrogen therapy.
Yes, we are not Hello. Having the experience. Hello?
You are getting gels now. Intrauterine, you can push the gel. Adhesion barrier gels.
Is available in the name of what agents? What are.
Antijoin.
Yeah, that is in Dubai. Here
yes.
In
India. No.
sir, in India also, the orthopedicians are using this gel. So you find out from your orthopedician friend, they will be able to tell you about this gel. We had got once, but what I thought was once you inject inside, after you deflate the cavity, okay? Mm-hmm. I'm not very sure how long the gel is going to remain inside. Because this is a very muscular cavity. As soon as the fluid is going to go off, both the surfaces are going to be in touch with each other. So how this gel helps to prevent, I have really no idea, sir. Hello?
Yes.
Sandesh, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, so Sanket and me recently started using the, there is a hysteroscopic Foley's catheter available with the Cook company. It's not a regular Foley's catheter. It's a triangular shape
yes.
Balloon.
Yeah.
And this is, I think 3 ml, with 3 ml it will inflate, and it will inflate exactly like a size of the uterine cavity. I think that should be something which we all should be trying to keep it for 7 to 10 days, and with estrogen to grow the over that area in the meantime, when the you are maintaining the distension of the cavity. And sometimes we give sildenafil citrate vaginally so as to increase the vascularity of that area, so that the more endometrium will grow over the cut surface area. So once you remove the balloon, we expect the cavity to be without any adhesions. This is my experience. Anybody else can definitely have open discussion on this.
2.5 to 3 ml maximum you should actually
it's 3 ml only. It's 3 ml.
All those Foley's bulb and all those things, you are actually creating pressure atrophy.
Pressure.
If the yttrium is there, you are damaging that also. If you keep it for Sanket, 7
do you have the photograph of that?
No, sir. Not that.
Balloon? Yeah. Not at anybody contact Cook people, they have this bulb. And it's not very expensive.
It's not very expensive. Yeah. I have seen this the triangular bulb, but I have not used actually. But I have seen
it's a very nice and it's reusable. So once you take it out, you can EPO it and use it again for, because the availability of it is very difficult. Any more questions in the chat box?
Chat boxes, there is one question that GNRH will destroy the plane in hysteroscopy, myomectomy, and will make it difficult. But I don't think so. What does Dr. Sanket say?
No, there is no relation to doing hysteroscopic myomectomy and difficulty of hysteroscopic myomectomy. In laparoscopy, yes, but in hysteroscopy, no, not really.
In laparoscopy, you are actually pulling out the fibroid. Here, you are cutting into the, there is no question of planes.
Okay.
I think the literature also recommends use of GNR gyros. There are many studies to favor its use.
Yes.
Okay.
So this is the
balloon. Yes. Excellent. Vimi, excellent. Vimi.
Thank you, sir. Google hai na, sir.
Aha, jo bhi hai, acha hai. So all the participants are getting benefit out of this. Okay.
Yes.
So
thank you very much for this opportunity. And actually, I should congratulate Isar and Kedar and mainly Sanket, because I listened to their laparoscopic discussion and it was so fantastic. And today's panel was very young and very, very well read. So I'm really happy to listen to all those. And thank you for involving me also in this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. It is great to have you, and coming from you, it means a lot to all of us.
Thank you so much. I think
we also should thank Dr. Kundan Engle, who represents the FOCSI Infertility Committee. So it's a joint venture, and our motto is to give promotion to all the so-called budding IVF and hysteroscopic laparoscopic surgeon, so that they will come out and publish some papers in the future. So
in ESAR journal.
ESAR journal maybe.
Definitely.
I would be happy to see that, because it's our own journal and it's got a very good impact factor. It's about 1.25, and if you see human reproduction, it's 4.5. So we are very close to that, and we have to submit our own. But I think first is start doing your publication. That is what, and I must see you all in the various conferences. Once this lockdown is going to be over, all of you are going to be involved in the next conferences. Thank you very much for being there. And
Kedar, sir, I think we should also thank Ramni Devi madam, who is also there in the audience right from the beginning till here. Okay. So she is vice president FOCSI and in charge for this committee, infertility committee.
So, why don't you unmute her? Somebody, please unmute her and invite her to, if she wants to say something.
Sir, she is not logged in with her name. Sir, can you guide by what name she has logged in?
I think she must have logged out now, right now, because she was logged in by her name, Ravni Devi madam, R, starting from R.
Right now, she is not there.
Okay.
Chalo, anyway. Sanket, you can sum it up.
Yeah, thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, all the panelists, Dr. Kedar, Dr. Kundan, sir, and everybody from ISAR and FOCSI for this wonderful opportunity. I think we had a great time and we gave a lot of take-home messages to the audience that they can use in their day-to-day practice. And I hope we keep meeting again. Thank you, everyone, for a very fruitful discussion. Thank you.
Amit, thank you very much. Amit, thank you so much. I've been troubling you left, right, and center.
No, sir. Thank you. Sir, we have Rajiv sir with us.